And now, broadcasting from deep behind enemy lines in the occupied territory of the Socialist Republic of California, your host, former California State Assemblyman and Governor candidate, Tim Donnelly.
Hey, welcome back to the Radio Free California Network. And here we are. The day has arrived. The first Democrat debate, which is being held in Las Vegas, probably a fitting place for the first debate to take place. And it will be, it's already becoming a bit of a sideshow. CNN's Anderson Cooper intends to keep it solemn and serious and treat the candidates with the dignity and respect that CNN did not afford the GOP candidates. But then again, who are we to whine about fairness, because we never see it with the biased, lamestream media. But CNN, in the interest of being completely in touch with the American people, has solicited debate questions, not from you, but from celebrities. So they wanted to know what celebrities would ask. And you're going to be shocked. There's not a single question for Hillary Clinton about emails. There's no questions about tax code for Bernie Sanders. You know what's strange? The celebrities and the Democrats seem to be completely focused on social issues almost exclusively. But isn't it funny that they tell Republicans, you shouldn't ever talk about social issues? It's destroying your party. You guys need to come to the center and just get along with us, and you just need to talk about the fiscal issues. And of course, the Republican Party listens to the advice of those who wish them to fail. And I have to laugh, because why would you ever listen to the advice of your enemy, of your opposition, of the opposite team that would like to defeat you? They're always going to give you advice that perhaps in the state in which you are, which Republicans have been so soundly defeated for so long, they have control of the Congress, but they just don't know it. They don't act like it. They continue to act like a defeated party. They can't get their act together. They can't even find a simple speaker and get behind somebody with some balls, somebody with some cojones, somebody with some testicular fortitude. But let me just take you to the things that are important to Democrat celebrities, just so that you can get a feeling for the most significant issues that Democrats want to talk about. So this is a question from Katy Perry. With the GOP crusade, there's a slightly pejorative term, to defund Planned Parenthood momentarily deflated, how do you intend to consistently protect American women seeking the legal, affordable health care that they so desperately require? Now, wait a minute, Katie. First of all, it's not a crusade. It is simply looking out. Going back to the whole fiscal issue, it's looking out for the taxpayer. Republicans, if they had any actual testicular fortitude, would be standing and dying on this hill, not because it's about abortion. They just need to make it clear. This is about a nonprofit that is making a profit. It is no longer a nonprofit. It is doing very deeply controversial and illegal and immoral things that have shocked the conscience of many people, not just Republicans, with our tax dollars. That's all. So when they talk about health care, legal, affordable health care they so desperately require, what are we really talking about here? Your right to an abortion? That's legal in this country. Nobody's stopping you. But the difference is that through Planned Parenthood, the Democrat Party is able to subsidize abortion. It is able to subsidize its own agenda. It is able to basically convert people using this so-called social issue. And Republicans are being told, take a back seat. You know, don't make any waves. We wouldn't want to make any enemies. Democrats don't care. They use this as a wedge issue. They use it to be divisive. They don't care about women's health care. If they cared about health care being affordable, they never would have destroyed the health care system with Obamacare. And a lot of ordinary Americans that work for a living, men and women, are waking up to the fact that Obamacare is an abject disaster. So, but see, this is the kind of questioning, and this is the narrative that will be supported, and it will be talked about in soft, dulcet tones about affordable health care. Well, it's not affordable health care. Obama already supposedly did that. You get free health care anywhere. You can go to an emergency room. You can go to a doctor's office. You don't have to go to Planned Parenthood, who chops up babies after they're aborted. That's just the fact. And they're doing it with my tax dollars. And that deeply offends me. And as an American, I'm not giving up my First Amendment. I'm certainly not giving up my right to protest and to demand accountability of my government. I mean, that's literally inculcated in our form of government, is the right to seek redress of our grievances from our government. See, that right there is what this Planned Parenthood defunding is about. It ain't about abortion. It ain't about affordable health care. It ain't about any of the garbage that the media likes to say it is. It is simply, absolutely, abjectly about whether or not a nonprofit is going to be able to steal $500 million from the government while operating a for-profit business. Any questions? Now, let's move on to Ashton Kutcher. And this is actually a fairly intelligent question. I got to give it to him. During your presidency, you will be faced with a robotic revolution. For example, driverless cars and semi-trucks, as machines take skilled and unskilled jobs from Americans. Well, we're seeing that right now. McDonald's and other fast food places are saying, look, we're not going to bow to the $15 an hour demands, because we know that's the beginning point. It's never going to stop until they have bereft us of whatever capital we have. So we're going to change our business model, and we're going to use robots and automation wherever we can. Well, this has been going on since the beginning of time. And what happens is you replace human beings in the labor force. So to further with his question, this will further hollow out the middle class and divide society. What do you propose we as a nation do to bridge the gap without stifling innovation? What will you do as president to maintain a country where everyone has upward mobility? That's a really good question. The end part of it is kind of a bad question, because he's implying that government should do something. And so that's one that I would throw out to you and say, should government do anything about the fact that robots are coming? And robots don't require health care. Robots don't require overtime. Robots don't require the management of human beings that is the biggest problem in almost every enterprise on the planet Earth. So, good question, Ashton Kutcher. 323-746-TALK. We will be taking your questions for the Democrat candidates. We'll have an update at some point during the show from Morgan Brittany, who is in Las Vegas on the ground. And we'll be talking to you all day long. 323-746-TALK. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. Welcome back to the Radio Free California Network. I am your host, former California State Assemblyman and radio governor in California. And we're talking about the Democrat debate. And I've been reading you questions. CNN decided instead of soliciting questions from viewers, they would solicit questions from celebrities, which is both a good and a bad idea, I suppose. But whenever you involve celebrities, you get more viewership. Unfortunately, they don't really have a celebrity candidate like Donald Trump, who, by the way, is going to be out there live tweeting the Democrat debate. So you need to fully expect all kinds of sound bites tomorrow. It's going to be a rich day in the aftermath of the Democrat debate. Another celebrity question. We just finished with Ashton Kutcher's, which was about robotics and what role they will play and what the president should do in response to that to guarantee upward mobility for everyone. The minute that you have as your goal guaranteeing the upward mobility of society by government, as opposed to by getting government out of the way, by getting obstacles out of the way, by creating a free market. Well, not creating it, but allowing it, enabling a free market. That's as far as government should be involved. And instead of working at McDonald's, your goal should be to own your own business. Your goal should be to have your own enterprise where you're the boss. And where you don't care about minimum wage, you don't care about whether or not somebody is going to tell you you could only work 4 hours, then you must take a break. And then, of course, you take a break right at the time when the business is busiest. So then you give the impression to the customers that nobody cares about them. And you're sitting in the back taking a state-mandated break. By the way, robots won't be taking those breaks. So another benefit. Neither do owners, by the way. When you're an owner, you don't abide by the rules of employees. You're an owner. So, you know, there's no guarantee of a paycheck. There's only a guarantee of endless hours of hard work, blood, sweat, and tears, and capital that you have put at risk that the government could steal from you or make it impossible for you to survive and recover. That is the benefit of being a small business owner. I can tell you from personal experience, being up at 3 o'clock in the morning working and filling out tax forms and writing checks to the government so that people who don't work for a living can have a nice, comfortable life. Yeah. And now you can write checks to the government so that people who don't work for a living can have better health care than you, while the government limits your choices, taxes your choices, and basically abuses you. So my answer to Ashton, that would have been my answer to Ashton Kutcher's question if I were a Democrat running for president. But then again, I would never be a Democrat running for president. Another celebrity, Demi Lovato, says, what's the biggest issue with our health care system when it comes to mental health care? And specifically, what would you do to fix it? That's a good question. It's a little bit of a softball. Shonda Rhimes, there is so much divisiveness in our government today. well, not really in our governments, in our society. Achieving anything of substance seems impossible because compromise seems impossible. What do you think needs to be done to unite Congress so that they are more working for the good of all the American people and less for the good of the partisan interests that seem to be currently halted any hope of legislative change or progress? Well, see, Shonda, it depends on what your goal is. If your goal is for government to fix every ill that you see in society, then, of course, you want everyone to get along. You want a kumbaya moment where everybody endorses the massive, unchecked growth of government via social programs, where you transfer wealth from those who have it, those who've earned it, those who've saved it, those who've inherited it. But you take and target that wealth and you redistribute it. Yeah, that's communism. And the whole point of that is to equalize outcomes. Well, if you equalize outcomes, and if you penalize production, if you penalize those who take risks, if you penalize those with capital who deploy that capital, well, then they will naturally rein that capital in and take all their marbles and go away. It's just the way the system works. Depending on the risk of what government is going to do to you, how heavily they're going to penalize you, those are the decisions that people with money make every day. They want to know whether there's any certainty that they will be left unharassed, unabused, and left alone to essentially create wealth for everyone. Now, obviously, their first goal is to create wealth for themselves and their shareholders. And that is a high calling. I know the indoctrination centers known as public schools, K through college, have demonized all wealth creation. They've demonized capitalism. They've demonized the individual initiative to the point that a lot of people believe it's evil to try to make money when it's actually one of the greatest goods. Because when you start your own company and you're able to create wealth where there was none. So let's say that you come up with an idea and you want to make a product. Well, what do? You're going to buy the raw ingredients of that product somewhere from someone. Then you're going to rent a building, presumably, or do it in your home. You're going to then either make the product yourself or hire people to make the product that you've figured out. You've come up with the intellectual capital, the intellectual, losing the name of it, but essentially the means and method of production are your intellectual property. Of course, unless, you know, someone takes photographs of it and sends it off to China to duplicate it in some unnamed factory somewhere, and all of a sudden it appears on the market for a lot less than you can make it. That's part of life now in our day and age, depending on what type of product. But as you develop this business, you deploy your capital. So you have to have some means, whether it's just your blood, sweat, and tears, your energy, your time, and your know-how. But at some level, you've got to buy the raw goods. Then you've got to get them to market. You've got to get somebody to buy them. You've got to transport them in some capacity. And of course, that means you're paying somebody to transport them. It means you might be paying somebody to market them. You might be paying somebody to distribute them. And at some point, you might even advertise on the Tim Donnelly Show and promote your product there. But the bottom line is that you are creating something where there was once nothing. That's private sector, free market, free enterprise. What Shonda Rhimes is pushing for, what Ashton Kutcher is pushing for, and what a lot of these Marxist progressive celebrities are pushing for, is for government to fill the gap, government to become the solution, government to grow and grow and grow until government becomes the solution to every single question. And by the way, that then ushers in Bernie Sanders point and almost makes it sound rational. If government is going to do everything for you, if government's going to cook your breakfast in the morning and government's going to, you know, I don't mean literally, you're going to go somewhere and get a free government breakfast. You're going to go somewhere and get free lunch. You're going to work for, presumably, the government, because private sector will be largely wiped out by this monolith. Then why wouldn't you be okay paying 90% of your taxes to government? 90% of your income. And see, that's where this is headed. And you can tell by the nature of the questions from the celebrities. All the wrong questions. We'll continue and take your calls after this break. 323-746-TALK.
Don't you think it's about time you treat yourself or someone you love to something very special? Well, Ozell Jewelers, the finest jewelry store in the High Desert, is known throughout the High Desert for having the largest variety of fine-looking jewelry and gifts for every special occasion. Ozell custom designs and manufactures their own jewelry, so you'll be able to find exclusive, one-of-a-kind, stunning styles you won't find anywhere else in Southern California. If you're looking for fine jewelry at unbeatable prices, Ozell Jewelers is the place to go. Show appreciation to that special person in your life with something special to cherish forever. Ozell Jewelers, voted best jewelers in the High Desert by the Daily Press regularly for years. Ozell Jewelers has been putting smiles on High Desert faces for over 30 years. Ozell Jewelers, in Rancho Cucamonga, Palm Desert, and Amargosa Road by Red Lobster in Victorville. Ozell Jewelers.
Hey, welcome back to the show. We're going to go straight to the phones and take a call from Steven in Sacramento. Steven, welcome to the show.
Right now, I got to think this whole Democratic convention is a joke. And these questions that you've read from celebrities, I am very suspect of that because they're not that bright. And those are pretty intelligent, you know, big words. And I just don't get, I don't think that's. That first one does not sound like Katy Perry, and I know somebody that met her backstage and thought she was a complete ditz, so that doesn't make sense.
Katy...
I know Ashton Kutcher's kind of smart, but...
Yeah, I mean, you have to have a certain amount of intelligence to be an actor, at least to be a comedian. I can attest to that. I'm friends with Rob Schneider, who is one of the smartest guys I've ever met, but... This Katy Perry, I think she's doing that just to act out against her parents.
I don't know why she'd be doing that.
Yeah, she was raised in a very, very strong Christian home. And so for her to start
doing gospel music.
Right. So for her to, you know, it's an act of rebellion. But Ashton Kutcher, it doesn't surprise me. The guy's moderately or certainly intelligent, and these are people who have had a certain amount of success.
Give him that. But I don't think he's as left as most Hollywood. I mean, I've met him before. He seems to be really down to earth and. No, he's like supporting of the military and troops, and I don't know if that was an act, but
I think Stephen, I think a lot of celebrities are conflicted because they know if they out themselves as conservatives, they can lose all kinds of work. I know a lot of conservatives in Hollywood, and many of them have to remain behind the scenes, and they live in the shadows. And
I was an extra in a couple of movies, so I know that one for sure.
Sure, but here's the interesting point though with Ashton Kutcher. He wasn't really asking a question that you could ascribe to right or left. It was more of an economic question, and of course, at the very end of his question, he implies that government should do something, but he doesn't give you the answer. Right. Maybe deep down inside, he doesn't want government to do anything. Maybe he's a libertarian and wants government to stay out of it.
I hope so. And then,
yeah, I don't know.
There's also one other thing I'd like. Right. There's one other thing I wanted to talk to you about. It was at the close of yesterday's program, and you were talking about a kid up in Oregon, I think it was, that got in trouble for wearing a T-shirt with the soldier's cross on it.
Right.
And as a combat vet, that really irritates the crap out of me. And the American flag and the Air Force logo in Texas, this is outrageous. And sort of an act of rebellion. My daughter put my combat infantry badge on her backpack and wore it to school today.
Nice.
And she did that to honor me and every other veteran out there. And nobody said a word because I know you're probably familiar with it, but for those that aren't, the combat infantry badge is given to members of the Army that have served in, you know, combat. And it has a long rifle in a blue rectangle, and mine has a silver wreath because I actually have two of them. But it has a rifle on it, so some people might get bent out of shape over that. But she actually didn't have any problems, and I was surprised but happy at the same time.
Well, here's the thing, Stephen, and this is my take on all of this. And first of all, thank you for your service. And thank you to everyone out there who is listening right now that has served this country. And I say that in part in reaction to these stories, because you shouldn't have to hear such stories. The story should be very simple. It should be some boneheaded idiot who's in charge of a school kicked a kid out because they wore, and then you fill in the blank, whatever it is, a logo that was too big, an American flag, you know, the soldier's cross, whatever it is, in whatever state it is. And then the next sentence should be, and 20 parents showed up and embarrassed the principal or vice principal or district superintendent and humiliated them and shamed them into doing the right thing. And that's the end of the story. There's not going to be any hearings. There's not going to be any denial of the First Amendment right. We are going to honor those who have secured our freedoms by having their backs here at home. And that's how I see that whole issue. And so anytime that you encounter this, and I'm talking to you, the listener, you have a moral obligation to step up, no matter how scared you might be, no matter how sick it might make you feel in your stomach to speak up. And believe me, I know what that's like. I used to be terrified to speak up at a PTA meeting or a school board meeting or any of that. Imagine that. But I was at once upon a time. I used to be just completely, absolutely terrified of people. I had social anxieties to such an extreme that I wouldn't come out of my office. So all of us can overcome that. But the other thing that we can do, when you see someone in uniform anywhere, just go out of your way and just shake their hand and say, thank you for your service. It's never an insult. It is never something that should make you feel uncomfortable, and it will always brighten their day no matter what. And I don't think, and I've done that many, many, many times, and I've always felt rewarded. And the few times I've been too embarrassed or wasn't feeling up to doing it, I later chastised myself. And so I use that as a motivation to continue to do that, because we have an obligation to be grateful as a nation that we have a volunteer force that is willing to go and defend our freedom. Okay, I'm off my soapbox, Stephen.
No, I'm in complete agreement. And people should stand up for this, because the people that support our troops and the people that support what they have done, our veterans and stuff, they're a majority, not a minority. Don't be afraid to speak out about that. And I will personally attest to the fact that when people thank you for what we've done, and I do it too, of course, you know, I've lost my sight now, but my wife will let me know when there's a uniformed person. When you say that, it makes all the difference in the world. It gives them it just secures them. I mean, it gives them the security. They know what they're doing is worth it. And even if it's once a week if they hear it, it makes a huge difference. Morale, troop morale is crucial. And when they know the people of America are supporting them and what they do, it makes the sacrifices they make seem not so bad, and they're really grateful.
Hey, Stephen,
I appreciate it all the time.
Stephen, I've got one question for you before you go. What would you ask at the Democrat debate? What question would you like answered by the Democrats? Or by a single Democrat? It's up to you.
I would ask Hillary Clinton why she is afraid to talk to a real average person, why she runs from them, why she doesn't take anything other than softball questions from real people, not pre-selected, not plants in her audience. That would be my biggest question. And I would also like to ask Bernie Sanders, if you're so into taking, you know, wealth distribution, why are you take millions of contributions for your campaign? That seems hypocritical. And put them on the spot.
No softballs here. Stephen, thanks for the call. We're going to take a quick break here and come back with more of your questions at 323-746-TALK. What would you like to ask the Democrat candidates? We'll forward on your questions the best we can right here on the air. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. For the Radio Free California Network, you found it. I am Tim Donnelly, your host, former California State Assemblyman and radio governor here in California, going to the phones. Bill from Hellendale with a question for Hillary. Bill, welcome to the show.
Global Initiative with Frank Gustra. And I'd like to know why they're raping Africa one strip mine at a time. And I want to know why, when they go in and promise the Congo and other countries that they're going to share the profits in these mines, that they then refuse to do it and tell the Congo that there was no profits. And there is accusations coming out of Africa, especially from black Africans, about the situation there that includes murder, child rape. It's just unbelievable what's coming out of there. And,
Bill, I would be shocked if there were anything happening like that in Africa with our first African-American president. You've got to be kidding me.
Well, you know, the United Nations sanctioned Banro Mining and some of these other corporations of Frank Gustra. And when it came down to Hillary to do the same thing, to stop relations with these mining firms, she refused. And then we find out that over $100 million went from these mining groups to her Gustra and Clinton initiative. So if anybody has 5 minutes, you can look it up.
Sure, but that's always the case. By the way, thanks for the call. That's always the case with anything in politics. You got to follow the money. You follow the money, and it doesn't matter whether you're talking about mining in Africa or you're talking about mining in Nevada or mining anywhere or data mining. Let's not go back to emails here, but in the end, there's an incestuous pool, and you have donors who want access, and those donors are willing to give tremendous amounts of money. Why is that? Because once they have access, and when I say access, I'm talking about hanging out, partying, drinking, having intimate dinners with, and everything that goes in between that, not just, you know, having a formal sit down in the office. These are people who become very, very close, or they wind up becoming quote unquote friends. And as a result of that, that impacts, greatly impacts the decision making on behalf of the individuals under whom, who basically have the power to make, to clear the way or make something go away or make something happen on behalf of a donor. And to a certain degree, a lot of it is legal that happens, but a great deal of it is wrong and immoral, because you can see clearly if somebody has a contract in front of you and they're willing to give you money, they expect you to vote their way. So then the question becomes, what do you do? Do you recuse yourself from that vote and say, look, I'm not going to vote at all? Do you vote against it in order to show that the money didn't affect you? Or do you go ahead, what if you think it's a great idea? Do you, can you then vote in good conscience in favor of a contract for which you basically were paid to vote in favor? And those are the moral questions facing our elected officials every day. And of course, you'll have to be the decider of whether or not they make the right decisions. All I can tell you is we have a system that is clearly rigged in the favor of the insanely powerful, monolithic, mega interests. I don't like using the word special interest because it's lost all meaning. These are mega interests. These are people with major, massive amounts of capital, not just money. They can also destroy a person. And they work at doing both. We're watching it play out. We watched it play out in the speaker's race. Somebody threatened Kevin McCarthy. He didn't just walk away from the job that he clearly wanted. It's strange because nobody else seems to want it. That's a story in and of itself. I'm going to go back to our celebrity questions. You're welcome to call in with your question, 323-746-TALK, and we'll take them all through the show today. And by the way, stay tuned for later on. We're going to have an update from Morgan Brittany, who is on the ground in Las Vegas, and she is doing interviews. She is walking around collecting data and information and whatever sound bites she can get as a correspondent for politichicks.com. And she is going to call in at some point and give us an update. Here's a question from Elton John. And it's not going to surprise anybody. It's about AIDS. In spite of great progress, HIV/AIDS is dramatically on the rise in the U.S. South. What would you do as president to stop this epidemic, particularly among minority communities? Well, that hasn't changed. That's probably the same question Elton John asked President Ronald Reagan slightly before AIDS. Well, actually, AIDS was just coming on the scene, but okay. Well, that's news to me. I was not aware that it was making a comeback anywhere, but evidently it must be, or Elton John wouldn't be asking that. Look, that's a legitimate question. And then once again, what is the role of government? If this is an epidemic, we know what the government would do here in California to prevent one case of measles. They're willing to take away the civil rights of hundreds of thousands of Californians, kick their kids out of school, and basically line them up and force them to take shots, or no more public school setting for you. So are they willing to play that tough with the people who are spreading AIDS throughout these minority communities? Or when you say minority communities, does that mean you can't actually tell the truth about whatever is happening to spread this disease, which I suspect is, of course, homosexual behavior and needles, which are shared, and drugs. And it's going to take some tough love. There's no government program going to fix that. Another question, if you're just tuning in, CNN solicited debate questions from celebrities. I guess they'd rather hear from celebrities than you. We'd rather hear from you than celebrities. But meanwhile, and we'll take your questions, any question that you have for any of the Democrat candidates that are running for president, or you can ask the entire group as a whole. This is from Juliana Margulies. Next year, the citizens in Nevada will vote an initiative to require the same Brady background checks that are conducted at licensed gun dealers to be conducted at for sales made at gun shows and online. Do you support that initiative? And as president, would you seek to make it federal law? So once again, another liberal who is probably protected by armed personnel wants to deprive you of whatever freedom you have to buy a gun in Nevada, and then wants to spread that statewide. That shouldn't surprise anyone. We've talked about gun control in this program over and over and over again. But the bottom line is there is no gun control. You can't control guns. It's all about controlling people. See, that's the entire agenda is people control and government control over the population. Don't let them fool you. We'll be right back with more of the Tim Donnelly Show right after these breaks. Hey, if you like shooting as much as I do, you've probably been to a lot of ranges. Unless you visited Burro Canyon Shooting Park, you've never seen anything like it. On the way there, you'll find yourself taking pictures as you traverse the majestic Azusa Canyon and wind your way up into the Angeles National Forest. With over 600 acres, including 19 private ranges, there's something for everyone. There's rifle and pistol ranges for beginners right up to advanced shooters. And there's plenty of spaces to shoot sporting clay. You can make a family day of it, or you can bring a group for team building exercises. Bring a picnic lunch. On the weekends, they provide lunch. And don't worry, they always have ammo in case you forget yours or run out. One thing I can guarantee is that once you visited my friends at Burro Canyon Shooting Park, you'll be hooked and you'll keep coming back. BurroCanyon.com is their website, or call them at 626-910-1344. 626-910-1344. Hey, you are tuned in to the Tim Donnelly Show, which broadcasts 3 to 6 p.m. every weekday on the Radio Free California Network. And you can hear us on this station. You can hear us online. We stream live. And, of course, if you miss a show, you can go to timdonnellyshow.com, click on previous shows, and get caught up on all the important opinions, including your own, because we take your calls. We're taking your calls today. What would you like to ask the Democrat candidates? I think the right question at this point could literally split the field, could change the entire dynamic in this race on either side of the aisle. We saw earlier, and we'll get into it later, a question by a Jeb Bush staffer to Donald Trump and how that created consternation. But see, this is what they do. They plant people in the audience. And if you're not politically savvy, and even if you are sometimes, you're just going to get caught. You have to take questions. It's just Political politics 101. So we will take your questions, 323-746-TALK. Meanwhile, CNN has asked celebrities and celebutants to submit questions. And we've been reading you some from Ashton Kutcher, Elton John, and other myriad B-list celebrities. We've got Melissa Etheridge, who has a question for the Democrat debate for the candidates. Cannabidiol. I don't know if I'm saying that right. It sounds like cannabis oil, but it's spelled C-A-N-N-A-B-I-D-I-O-L. Cannabidiol. I don't know. If somebody wants to help me take a stab at that, go ahead and call us. But it's also known as CBD, so we'll just call it that. It's an oil, so I got that right, derived from hemp that never should have been lumped together with the definition of marijuana. I actually agree with that. Legalized in 15 states, including Georgia, Texas, Tennessee, Virginia, Washington, Oklahoma, CBD has been shown to have a dramatic anti-seizure effect. But in order for the families in those states to obtain CBD, well, that doesn't make any sense. In order for families who are not in those states to obtain CBD, most would have to break federal law that treats CBD as a controlled substance. Oh, I see. Okay. And it's legal in those states, but it's still illegal on a federal level as a controlled substance. Well, this is not a complicated question. It's a good question. This is uncomfortable nexus between federal control, centralized control, federal government, and the 10th Amendment. What is the state's rights? And the federal government seized control a long time ago of certain substances, and they made it their business to take control of the so-called controlled substances. Hence, the massive creation of the drug industrial complex, the DEA, and all kinds of other organizations with these alphabet soup names that basically created a great living for an army of regulators. And a lot of these substances are being legalized by states, but then you wind up in trouble on a federal level, which is ludicrous. This stuff should be sorted out. The federal government needs to hand over control of many of these substances to the states. It should be decided by the people who live in each of these states rather than an out of control federal government thousands and thousands of miles away. I don't know. What do you think? I would love to know what you think about that question. I hope somebody asks that. I will be watching. I will be listening. I hope that somebody asks that and that that question is answered. Because you know what? There's room at the table for some common sense coming from Democrats. That would be nice. There's room for those who believe in states' rights to stand up and say, hey, the state should have more control. They've turned, the Democrats, by the way, have turned states' rights into an evil word that is somehow synonymous with wanting to support slavery. And yes, at a time it was, but it doesn't mean that anymore. Now, it is strictly about every duty that is not enumerated and handed over. And by enumerated and handed over, if it's enumerated by the Constitution, it belongs to the federal government. That means protecting our borders. Yeah, epic fail there. If they got back to protecting our borders and doing nothing else, maybe maintaining the interstate highways and nothing else, I don't even need them to do the mail. If we got the government out of the postal business, if we got them out of the business of interpreting mountains and monolithic amounts of tax code and making your life a living hell, if we just had a flat or fair or whatever tax that could be swiped with a credit card and you pay what's due and you don't have to create mountains of paperwork, can you imagine how simple life would be and how much more time we'd have and how much less afraid of our government we would be? Can you imagine that? But people are terrified. And they're terrified because we have a government that it has no interest in actually living up to the Constitution. That's why they always call it a living, breathing document. they don't want to be restricted in their control over your life, because that means that they won't have a job for the rest of their lives. If we got rid of 97,717 IRS agents and literally had a computer that just took your payments in and credited them to your account, which would not be a problem in this day and age to build, end of story. And if you didn't pay, they send you a little email automated by a computer. You wouldn't need any people because it would be automated. Yeah, maybe you need one or two people. Okay, fine, I'll give you that. But they wouldn't be enough to form a union. And then that union wouldn't be enough to threaten everybody. And then they wouldn't go after people who want to hold the government accountable and shrink it and want to see something for their tax dollars. But back to the question, it does raise the question of states' rights. It raises the question of whether any of these candidates understand the 10th Amendment. Don't hold your breath. I'm just throwing it out there. Who knows? Maybe one of them will come up with an answer that will surprise you. Certainly give them a chance to stand out from the crowd. Margaret Cho takes us right back to the Democrat social issues that they always advise the Republicans not to talk about. How do you allow LGBT couples who are now able to be married under the law full adoption rights in every state? How do we get equal rights to family? See, now here's someone who wants the federal government or the courts to overrule the states. She makes no bones about it. It's very simply there in her question. And there it is. I will leave that one stand and we will take a break. We'll take more of your questions. If you have a question, what would you like to ask Hillary Clinton or Jim Webb or Martin O'Malley or Bernie Sanders or Lincoln Chafee? Got a question? 323-746-TALK. We'll be right back. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. Hey, this is Tim Donnelly, your host, former California State Assemblyman and radio governor here in California. And we're taking your questions. We're also picking apart celebrity questions for the Democrat debate. So if you have a question, give us a call, 323-746-TALK. What would you like to ask Hillary? What would you ask any of the candidates? Of course, you've got Bernie Sanders on the far left, and you've got Martin O'Malley and Jim Webb and Lincoln Chafee sort of huddled around the irrelevant zone. Not quite sure where they stand on a lot of stuff, because, of course, the only candidates getting any attention are Hillary and Bernie. And I think it's going to be an interesting debate tonight. It's not going to be the free for all that you saw at the GOP debate held out at the Reagan Ranch, where CNN showed no decorum. They showed no restraint. They wanted to turn it into a sideshow. And, you know, what was interesting about that is there were a few candidates who figured out how to shine, and the rest largely were forgettable. And Donald Trump, no matter what they try to do to him, is still plugging away. I can't wait to follow. He's going to live tweet this thing tonight. Now, hopefully he does it sober. Because if he were to drunk tweet it, things would get real interesting real fast. I'm going to go back to the questions from celebrities. We've got Martha Plimpton with a question. The 1973 landmark Supreme Court decision Roe v. Wade ensured women's access to abortion throughout the U.S. Note, just note to self, the Democrats, all of these celebrities, I assume, are Democrats or Democrat-leaning or Democrat sympathizers. They might be full-blown Marxist progressives. They might be something less. But in the end, they're Democrats. The Democrats are the ones who continually tell the Republicans, stay away from social issues. Stay away from social. Stay away. Whatever you do, stay away from the social issues. Almost every question or 80% of the questions I've read from these celebrities are about social issues. They don't stay away from the social issues. They drive the social issues. They drive a deep wedge between people using social issues. I just want that to be made clear. The 1973 landmark Supreme Court decision Roe v. Wade ensured women's access to abortion throughout the U.S. Yet since then, we've seen a steady reversal of those, quote, air quotes here, constitutional protections in the states, with nearly 300 new abortion restrictions enacted in the last 5 years, more than the previous decade combined. Today, many women are worse off than they were before Roe, with access to this basic and legal healthcare procedure essentially out of reach. You know what? That's just bull. That is BS. There is not a single woman in America who cannot get a free abortion if she shows up and asks for one. We have a government that will subsidize your abortion. We have a government that many would like to subsidize your birth control. Remember Sandra Fluke? She didn't want to pay for her own birth control. She doesn't want anyone else to have to be responsible for their own lives. There is no way in the United States of America that you should ever have to pay for anything if you can get the government to pay for it. That is a mentality that is so corrosive. Forget about abortion. Forget about birth control. This is about demanding that your neighbor pay for your crap. Sorry. That's what I would say to her. I'm going to continue with Martha Plimpton's question. It's sort of an epic question that never ends. Is it time for federal legislation such as the Women's Health Protection Act or the Each Woman Act to protect every woman's right to reproductive health care? Will you fight for legislation that would ensure safe and legal abortion is available to all women regardless of their zip code? You know, I hope they ask that question. Because after the Planned Parenthood scandal, after the expose showing what's really going on in the largest publicly funded abortion operation in the country, I think a lot of Americans are having second thoughts about having their tax dollars used to subsidize such practices. That's all I'm going to say. And the Democrats may feel really confident. They may feel like this is their cornerstone issue. I'm not going to give them the same advice they've given to Republicans and tell them to stay off social issues. I'm going to say, Democrats, go down that path. Careen down that path, because I don't think the American public is with you as tightly as you believe. And I think it's one thing for abortion to be legal. It's another thing for you to force every American to pay for somebody else's abortion, to pay for their birth control, to pay for everything for them, while the same operation is no longer a nonprofit. It is a government-funded
baby parts selling factory. That's what your Planned Parenthood abortion clinic has become. It is not about women's health. This is about the proper role of government and whether or not our money should be used for such things. And I think if you took a poll of the American people right now, I think an awful lot of people who would define themselves as pro-choice would say, no, I am not in favor of having my money used for Planned Parenthood. Sorry. I'm not on board. At all. So, anyway, it's going to be fascinating to watch Donald Trump live tweet. This is the tweet he put out. At the request of many, and even though I expect it to be a very boring 2 hours, I will be covering the Democrat debate live on Twitter. Donald Trump's use of social media has driven a lot of coverage to his campaign, even sparking a story from the New York Times about his Twitter habits. Quote unquote, Mr. Trump has mastered Twitter in a way no candidate for president ever has, unleashing and redefining its power as a tool of political promotion, distraction, score settling, and attack, and turning a 140-character task that other candidates farm out to young staff members into a centerpiece of his campaign. That's New York Times reporter Michael Barbaro earlier this month. I think it's going to be fun to watch the showdown between Hillary and Bernie Sanders. Hillary can't be happy to have a guy like Bernie Sanders stealing her thunder. She's the presumptive nominee. So for this upstart to come along and steal away her thunder, it's got to piss her off. And so I'm hoping, I wish we were able to cover this live, because then maybe we could have a little Democrat debate bingo. And of course, every time you hear certain words, or if Hillary gets really shrill, you'd have to take a shot versus just a drink. But it's unfortunately starts at 5:30. We will bring you some of it. We will bring you the beginning of this debate, and I guarantee you that it will not be the free-for-all, the entertaining free-for-all that the GOP debate at the Ronald Reagan Library was, where Jake Tapper of CNN provoked a near fist fight between candidates. It might be a snooze fest, but we're going to bring it to you. Stay tuned. Hey, if you like shooting as much as I do, you've probably been to a lot of ranges. Unless you visited Burro Canyon Shooting Park, you've never seen anything like it. On the way there, you'll find yourself taking pictures as you traverse the majestic Azusa Canyon and wind your way up into the Angeles National Forest. With over 600 acres, including 19 private ranges, there's something for everyone. There's rifle and pistol ranges for beginners right up to advanced shooters. And there's plenty of spaces to shoot sporting clay. You can make a family day of it, or you can bring a group for team building exercises. Bring a picnic lunch. On the weekends, they provide lunch. And don't worry, they always have ammo in case you forget yours or run out. One thing I can guarantee is that once you visited my friends at Burro Canyon Shooting Park, you'll be hooked and you'll keep coming back. BurroCanyon.com is their website, or call them at 626-910-1344. 626-910-1344.
Get your motor running.
Welcome back to the Radio Free California Network. I am your host, Tim Donnelly, former California State Assemblyman and radio governor here in California. We're going straight to the phones, where we have actress Morgan Brittany, who is covering the Democrat debate in Las Vegas. Morgan, welcome to the show.
Hey, it's good to be with you, Tim. Wow, it is, behind enemy lines, huh?
Yeah, you are behind enemy lines, aren't you?
Yeah.
You're now, tell us what's going on there.
Okay, well, it's really different from the Republican thing. It's not as many people, not as much press, not as much buzz. However, they're talking about Trump. It's unbelievable. The whole buzz is about Trump and how he's going to Twitter everything on his account tonight. I mean, it's hilarious. I'm walking through the halls, and that's all I'm hearing is, can you believe this? It's him. He had to spin it so that it's all about him. I mean, everybody
well, of course, that's brilliant.
Talking. Yeah, it is brilliant. It's
why are they so afraid of Trump?
You know what? I think it's because he pulls the spotlight. This is their big deal. And they've been, you know, I've been watching it on CNN closed circuit and some of this stuff today. And it's all about, you know, they're trying to be so serious and they're trying to talk about, you know, their candidates are so amazing and great. And then all of a sudden, this whole Trump thing comes out and he's just stealing everything. I mean, the guy is a genius. There's no question.
Well, and we are excited to see his live tweeting. We actually just made an executive decision here at the Radio Free California Network to live stream the debate. And with our commentary after the show goes off air, you will be able to stay on our stream and listen. And part of what we're going to cover is how people are covering this, because I think it's going to be kind of a boring debate in and of itself, don't you?
Well, here's the thing. From what I understand, I just talked to somebody who got out of a press conference with, with Harry Reid. And I guess the instructions coming down from Reid is that they want to tear the Republicans apart. That's going to be their main theme tonight, is that they're going to go after the Republicans big time. I think there's kind of a warning going out, don't attack each other. But to tell you the truth, McNally and Chafee and Jim Webb, they're going to have to do something to move themselves out of out of oblivion. They're going to have to do something. So it wouldn't surprise me if Jim Webb emerges tonight, because he's somebody to watch. He really is. He's kind of a silent threat here. But from what I understand, they're really going to go hard after the Republicans.
Okay, but going hard after the Republicans ignores the massive jackass in the room, which is Hillary's email.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I get it that they're going to attack Republicans. That's like saying they're going to drink water today.
I know.
What about Hillary? Do you think anybody is going to raise any hard questions to her?
Well, that's what I'm saying. The only people that really need the publicity and they need to get out into the spotlight are going to be Jim Webb, McNally, and Chafee, which I'm putting my money on Webb. But whether they're going to go after her or whether they've been warned not to, I don't know. That's the big elephant in the room right now. Elephant in the room, right?
Yeah. No. See, I changed it to jackass because it's the donkey. Come on, let's stay current here. So, have you had a chance to talk to anybody? Have you seen any of the candidates in person?
No, actually, there's going to be a photo spray here at about 15, so I'm going to head on over there. But I'm going to try. I don't even know what kind of access I'm going to have. I mean, we have a lot of access at the Republican debate. Most everybody came out and talked to everybody. But I don't know what that's going to be like here.
Well, I know you had a question for Bernie Sanders. I don't know if they can hear us there in Las Vegas, but
My question for Bernie was, is he really okay with a 90% tax rate on the American people? Whether he'd answer it or not, I don't know. But I'll tell you, it's really, I mean, the security here is unbelievable. I have never seen so many police officers, Secret Service. I mean, it's incredible. Way over what the Republicans had.
Well, I suppose that's due to Hillary being, you know, at one point a constitutional officer, former first lady. They do get Secret Service protection at a very high level for the rest of their lives. But
yeah, but if she's not, I mean, she's not even come down yet. And I mean, they're, you know, it's really kind of crazy. I walked down a hall today and I must have been confronted by three police officers in uniform. It was the most bizarre scene, just incredible.
So we've got actress Morgan Brittany undercover at the Democrat convention, the Democrat debate, excuse me. And have you talked to any other journalists? I mean, what is the sense and what's the feeling on the ground? Is there excitement? Is there buzz, or is it kind of boring?
No buzz. It's almost like they're kind of like going, let's get on with it. Let's get over with. They're not going to do anything. That seems to be the general consensus in the press room. It's pretty funny though, because as I'm walking around, people are turning around and they're going, wait a minute. Why do I know you? Do I know you? And then a couple people are going, wait, didn't you used to be on Dallas? What are you doing here? So I'm not really undercover, so to speak. But actually, I have been, I've been treated very nicely. I mean, the press has been great. Everybody's, you know, very, very, very nice. And I'm just curious to see where this thing goes, because I'm just waiting for somebody to do something.
And it is kind of strange that they invited you to come cover the Democrat convention. How'd you pull it off?
You know, I honestly don't know. I mean, I know that when I went to you know, the Republican one, I got into a conversation with one of the ladies at CNN, and she said, oh, this is so great that you're here. I'm so excited. And I don't know whether she had anything to do with,
was she a fan,
you
think?
My email address. Yeah, she was. She knew all my work and everything. And she said, oh, this is so great. This is awesome that you're here. So maybe that had something to do with it.
She obviously did not Google any of your articles.
No, she
because
didn't
you are one of the hardest hitting opinion writers that I have ever met, and you package it well. You come across being this super nice, wonderful, bipartisan, happy-go-lucky actress, but in reality, you have written some pretty hard-hitting stuff.
Well, wait, today I have an article coming out on WorldNet Daily tonight about gun control. I love that one. So I'm hitting them hard on that one. Oh, there goes Debbie Wasserman Schultz. Holy moly.
Go ask her a question.
Okay. She's gone. She had about 40 people with her, so she's gone.
Oh, no. We would have live streamed it.
Really? I don't know who's going to come by. Let's see. Oh, my gosh. Well, anyway, it's pretty interesting. I'm going to live blog on Facebook as well. So I'm going to try to catch your thing, too, if I can.
We'll see
where it goes.
Yeah, we'll watch your you're going to stream it on Facebook or Twitter?
On Facebook.
All right. We'll look for your comments on Facebook and share them with the audience so that they get a sense of what's happening on the ground. And Morgan, thank you for taking the time to call in to the Tim Donnelly Show in the middle of your adventure.
Yeah, good. Right. Wolf Blitzer, hey, Wolf Blitzer just bought a banana.
News at 11. You should go ask him and say, look, is anybody going to ask any tough questions tonight?
I know it. I'm going to head back in there. I'm going to go into the spin room right now, and I'm going to see if I can corner some of these people.
All right. If you come up with anything, I'll share your comments here on the air. But thanks for calling in and checking in with us, and good luck in tonight's coverage. Hopefully you'll get some sound bites and some make some interesting acquaintances.
All right.
That's Morgan Brittany at the Democrat debate in Las Vegas, live on the floor as we tick down to the it's a 5:30 start time. And we've decided that we're going to keep our stream going. We're going to have a live stream tonight. So if you want to actually listen and get some commentary, you're going to have to do it on either on your phone at timdonnellyshow.com, go to listen live, or you're going to have to do it from your computer. Either way, it isn't that complicated. You can also go to tunein.com. That's an application, a TuneIn app, and download that app, and then just go to Radio Free California Network. And you can listen, and you can also call in. See, that's the funny thing. We can keep our phones going and keep your commentary coming in should you wish to opine. We're going to take a quick break. 323-746-TALK. Be right back. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. Hey, you have found the Radio Free California Network, and we are going to stream live commentary on the Democrat debate. So you do not have to listen alone. You might, who knows, you might even devise your own drinking game, which people have been known to do to alleviate the boredom. Not that I am trying to encourage anyone to drink. However, it is... You gotta think of creative ways to make watching this debate tolerable. Because I agree, we just had actress Morgan Brittany on, who is live on the ground there. I agree, this is going to be a snooze fest. One of your drinking triggers might be every minute that goes by when the moderators don't ask the one tough question of Hillary that somebody on the Democrat side of the aisle needs to ask. And they need to ask it to defend their credibility. What kind of credibility do you have if you allow an individual who is your standard bearer, who has been your front runner, who, as Donald Trump has aptly said, belongs in jail? And so I think it's a valid question. It's a good question. 323-746-TALK. What would you ask? What do you want to ask Hillary? What do you want to ask Bernie Sanders? If anything, just curious. We read earlier all of the questions from the celebrities. And there were some decent questions, but most of them address the social issues. Most of them, as Morgan Brittany has said, they're going to spend the bulk of their time demonizing Republicans. Okay. Who wants to listen to that? I mean, you could just turn on NBC, CBS, or ABC and listen to Republicans being demonized. You can turn on CNN any day of the week and hear Republicans demonized. I want to know what their vision is for this country. I would like someone to ask, do you love America? Wouldn't you like to hear the answer to that? Wouldn't you like Hillary Clinton to be asked, do you believe that America is the greatest nation on the face of the earth? I'd like to hear Bernie Sanders be asked that, because he obviously believes we should become a socialist nation. Barack Obama's got us halfway there. He wants to finish off the work that was started by Obama. He wants to kill the capitalist and free market nature of our economic structure in favor of the government stealing and depriving you of 90% of your earnings in order that the government be your caretaker from cradle to grave. All hail government. Government becomes everything. Government becomes your God. Government replaces God. Government replaces your own initiative. If you take 90% of someone's paycheck, what do you think they're going to do? They're going to stop working, or they're going to stop engaging in the activity that enables you to steal 90% of their efforts. It's just human nature. So, yeah, I would like someone to challenge Bernie Sanders and say, so once you have taxed everyone 90% in the first year, what do you think the likely outcome will be in year two, in three, and four? And then how does that, given that you are predicating cradle to grave socialist style healthcare and basically life care, where your every need is met by the government. So you're going to massively increase spending on social programs to justify your 90% taking. Well, how's that going to work if in year two, the number of people working falls off by 50%? And in year three, when that number drops another 50%, and then in year four, the same thing, and you basically have 25% of the population that was originally working is now not. I'm sorry, 25% is all that's left, and 75% of those working have said, screw it, I'm just going to get on the government dole, and or if I'm a very wealthy person, I'm just stepping out of the game. I'm not going to put any of my capital at risk. I'm going to hold all my money in offshore accounts. I'm going to engage in no economic activity in the United States. And when rich people don't engage in economic activity, that craters jobs. Jobs fall apart. You have a shortage of jobs, a massive, massive shortage, because they're never created. Because the government killed them by stealing 90% of the money that's risked in order to create them. So that's the sort of questions that I would like to hear asked. If you have a question for any of the Democrat candidates, you can feel free to contact us by phone at 323-746-TALK or on Facebook, Twitter, all of it you can find at timdonnellyshow.com. And by the way, stay tuned, because when this show ends and goes off air, we're going to stay on the stream and have live commentary from till at least 7 p.m. right here at timdonnellyshow.com, Radio Free California Network. Be right back. Hey, you are listening to the Radio Free California Network. And if you're just tuning in, where have you been? We've been having a great time, a great conversation, but you're just in time. And by the way, the Democrat debate, the Snooze Fest in Las Vegas, is going to begin at 5:30 Pacific time, 8:30 Eastern, and will be broadcast, of course, on CNN. CNN has made it clear that they intend to bore you to death. So we thought it might be fun to offer a little live commentary. We will pull in Twitter feeds and Facebook feeds and throw questions and comments and who knows, maybe even suggest at the behest of others when you might imbibe in alcoholic beverages, take a drink or a shot at the request of some individual out there who is suggesting a question on, and this will all be after 6 p.m. So this is not for radio broadcast, but it'll be on our live stream at timdonnellyshow.com. You can also, if you want to play along with your phone, you can go to the TuneIn app, download it. It's just TuneIn. Download that app and search Radio Free California Network. And you will be connected with our live stream. And we'll keep the phone lines open, 323-746-TALK. That way you can comment. I really think the Democrats have a lot to answer for. And I also believe that Wolf Blitzer and Anderson Cooper and all these other types are never going to ask them the hard questions, whether in a debate forum or whether in an interview forum. You've got some of these news stations like NBC that have bent over backwards for weeks to try to rehabilitate and resuscitate Hillary Clinton. There's no way on the planet Earth they're going to ask her a tough question. And here's the thing. If you're going to run for president, you need to lay it on the line. And I think a lot of people would respect that if you did it. Bernie Sanders has laid it on the line. The guy is out there. He says, look, I am a full-blown Democrat socialist. I want to take everything you earn and give it to other people who didn't earn it. I want the government to do everything. And, you know, I don't apologize for it. And he is gaining an incredible amount of traction. He has engaged the youth of America, at least the Democrat youth. And Hillary seems to be shrinking and falling and crashing and burning. And she doesn't like to hold herself out for interview with anybody but the softest of the softballs. Because even with a softball, she can spin herself into a tizzy and get so shrill that her handlers have to come up and grab her and pull her away. And we have a temperament like that. Unlike Trump, Trump is a laser beam. He hones in on his target and he annihilates them, but he does it with some humor, with hair flying. And, you don't know whether to laugh or cry, but it certainly is entertaining. And of course, Donald Trump is going to be live tweeting. I'm looking at his Twitter feed right now. His question right now is, will CNN be as tough as they were with Donald Trump? Well, of course, you know, his answer is going to be no way, not even a chance. But, you know, we had actress Morgan Brittany on, who is in Las Vegas on the ground, who made it clear that they're, the talk of the town is not Hillary Clinton. It's not Bernie Sanders. It's Donald Trump. I think they're afraid of him. I think they're afraid of Donald Trump. That's why you have such an obsession. You have people covering every single thing that he does, even if it isn't newsworthy per se. You've got Greta Van Susteren saying CNN should invite Donald Trump to the debate. If they can invite a socialist, Bernie Sanders, to the Democrat debate. But by the way, did you know Bernie Sanders is not a Democrat? He's an independent. He's not a Democrat, by the way. He is a socialist. You don't have to be a Democrat to be a socialist. You can be a socialist all on your own.
most of the Democrat leadership are Marxist, progressive, socialist, slash communists. Anyway, she wants to know, why can't he get invited? You know, if they invited Donald Trump, there'd be a lot more coverage. You would have people coming out of the woodwork because they would be looking for that fight. And here's the part that I'm not even going to say the GOP understood it, because the GOP really wanted to keep Trump out of the debate. But Donald Trump understands stagecraft. He understands that controversy is the mother's milk of promotion. You've got to have that edge. You've got to have that controversy in order to get covered. Nobody cares what your opinion is of what is going on in the Ukraine unless you're someone like Donald Trump, who's going to say something about Putin that can be boiled into a soundbite and looks like the two are going to have a fist fight or, you know, or a bromance, either one. But there's got to be some level of intrigue and interest and spark, because the American public is at a point now where they're less informed about politics than ever before. So you have to do a lot of work to get them to actually pay attention. And with by putting Donald Trump in on the big stage, which of course they didn't have any choice about, and then by making it clear they were going to provoke a fist fight, well, of course, people were not tuning in to hear Marco Rubio's foreign policy ideas. People were tuning in to see if there would be an actual fist fight on the stage. And I don't think CNN quite understands that. So it's going to be possibly a snooze fest, but we're going to liven it up here for you with your comments and with our commentary on the live stream starting at 6 p.m., but we will give you some coverage starting at 5:30. We'll begin to live stream it for you. And we're going to take a quick break and be right back with your calls. 323-746-TALK. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. Well, I've just been informed that Hillary's motorcade has just arrived in Las Vegas. I'm sure that she probably has the same size entourage as Michelle Obama in order to make herself feel important. It must be a sight to see. We're going to go straight to the phones. We've got Paul from Newberry Springs. Paul, welcome to the show.
Hi, Kevin. Thank you.
Yeah, hey, what is your question for the Democrat candidates?
Okay, well, since all of them are socialists and Marxists, I would like to ask them, how honest is it of them, given that political slant, to run for office in a democratic republic?
You mean a constitutional republic?
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll grant you that. The other thing I would like to see, though, is some leadership out of the National Republican Party.
Oh, God.
Whoever gets knocked. Yeah, yeah.
You want leadership? Wait, whoever. You said the National Republican? And you want leadership?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I think you need to go to the WWE or WWF or whatever it's called. I'm sorry, but go on. I don't mean to interrupt. I just.
Okay, well, I can see we feel the same. So anyway, that whoever the Republican nominee is, to urge all Republicans to vote for that person and not vote for one of these Democrats because my Republican isn't the nominee.
Well, yeah, good luck with that. Any kind of leadership within the Republican Party is an oxymoron. And I'm not saying anything about the current leader of the Republican National Committee, but it just doesn't exist. They've spent all their time trying to keep Donald Trump out of the race, and he's the only one worth a damn, at least in terms of picking a fight, putting the issues on the front page, connecting with people, and literally giving voice to my concerns, to your concerns, to other people's concerns. Anyway, what do you think the outcome is going to be tonight? I mean, do you think there's going to be much of a fight? Do you think any of the tough questions will be asked?
No, they're just going to throw them a bunch of softball questions, and they're going to, as a whole forum, whether it's the candidates or the folks sending out the questions, they're one of their goals is going to be to, sling mud at the Republican ticket, and so I don't think anything's going to come out of it. I'm not going to watch it because Marxists and socialists have nothing to say to me. I spent 23 years in the Army trying to do away with folks like that, and so why would I want to listen to them?
Well, I don't blame you, Paul, but we will be live streaming and commentating and interrupting at our leisure. But thank you for your call. Thanks for your questions. And we will talk to you again. Hey, look, it's my duty to pay attention to it. You don't have to, but I would encourage you because certainly you want to know what the other side is saying. And if they get up there and all they want to do is criticize Republicans, everybody's going to fall asleep. And if nobody breaks out, if nobody presents any kind of vision that is uniquely their own, I'm afraid that we're not going to see much of a contest, especially if you have someone like Donald Trump wind up being the nominee on the other side. And I'm going to check his Twitter feed and see if he's decided to say anything else prior to the. Yeah, here he is. Should be interesting, but too bad the three guys at less than 1% will be taking up so much time. But who knows? Maybe a star will be born. Unlikely. And then Donald Trump writes back to Greta Van Susteren. I'd rather see Donald Trump be the debate moderator. Now, that would be funny. And then the Hillary Love Fest on CNN is ridiculous. I feel bad for the other candidates, especially the non-criminal ones. Yeah, he's in full swing. it's definitely going to be an interesting evening with the real Donald Trump. That's his Twitter is, by the way, is at Real Donald Trump. And he says, they need to take the debate slow. A lot of low energy on the stage tonight. I hope not. And then another one. We will all have fun and hopefully learn something tonight. I will shoot straight. Call it as I see it. Both the good, the bad, and the ugly. Enjoy. Yeah, that sounds like Donald Trump's trying to be nice. But we will call it like we see it, and we will be bringing you an extra hour of the Tim Donnelly Show tonight on our live stream. which you can get to at timdonnellyshow.com. Just Google it. Go on the website, hit listen live, and it will open up a stream for you. Or you can do it right on your phone, and you can go to the TuneIn app, download the app, and you will be prompted to then search for us. You want to put in Radio Free California Network, and it will bring up our stream right on your phone, which is one of the amazing inventions in this day and age. Is certainly is exciting to be able to instantaneously. I mean, when you think about this, back in the days of someone like Abraham Lincoln, they would have a debate. And then the debate would not even, other than the people in the room, it wouldn't even hit the papers in your area till maybe a week later. And then they would take pamphlets, and they would print a pamphlet that would show you the different arguments that were made and present those. Sometimes they were published in the papers. Sometimes they were published by campaigns. But that's how people got their information. Now you can literally, in an instant, you can know what everybody's saying. You can know what they're wearing. You can know what they look like. You can hear their voice. You can share their comments on Facebook and Twitter and anywhere and everywhere you want, literally within seconds. So you don't have to miss a thing. And we will bring you the latest, including all of the questions asked by the celebrities. You had Ashton Kutcher. You have one that is, I think Katy Perry's is definitely going to be asked, because they think that will embarrass the Republicans. And that is she wants to ask about them defunding Planned Parenthood. And I'm afraid, given her background, given that she was a gospel singer, given who she was and what her history is, the whole thing is designed to embarrass Republicans. It's amazing when an entire network decides to devote itself to biased coverage, to promoting a particular side instead of actually reporting and upholding any kind of objectivity or fairness or whatever the other words you want to use. But there is no journalism really in our news media. I mean, you have Fox, who covers things from a right-wing slant. You have CNN from a left-wing slant. Fox will generally give you more facts and interview more people. CNN tends to, especially when it comes to political things, their coverage of Hillary right now is off the charts. They're madly in love with her, and they can't hide it very effectively. And so be it. It is what it is. But we will bring you completely biased coverage, live commentary, where I will interrupt whatever is happening and tell you what I think of it, and tell you what other people think of it, what they're saying in social media, so that you don't have to do anything. But just tune in at timdonnellyshow.com or on your phone at, just download the TuneIn app and search for Radio Free California Network, and you will be connected to our coverage. And we will continue to take your calls and get your opinion coming up right after this break. 323-746-TALK.
Don't you think it's about time you treat yourself or someone you love to something very special?
Well, Ozell Jewelers, the finest jewelry store in the high desert, is known throughout the high desert for having the largest variety of fine-looking jewelry and gifts for every special occasion. Ozell custom designs and manufactures their own jewelry, so you'll be able to find exclusive, one-of-a-kind, stunning styles you won't find anywhere else in Southern California. If you're looking for fine jewelry at unbeatable prices, Ozell Jewelers is the place to go. Show appreciation to that special person in your life with something special to cherish forever. Ozell Jewelers, voted best jewelers in the high desert by the Daily Press regularly for years. Ozell Jewelers has been putting smiles on high desert faces for over 30 years. Ozell Jewelers, in Rancho Cucamonga, Palm Desert, and Amargosa Road by Red Lobster in Victorville. Ozell Jewelers.
Are tuned to the Radio Free California Network, and we are about to bring you live coverage of the debate. But before we do so, we're going to go to the phones, take a quick call from Bill in Phelan. Bill, what is your question for the debate tonight?
Well, my first question for Hillary for the debate tonight would be with the recent uncovering of the sensitive things that she said and naming names of people that could get killed on her email server, an unsecured email server, how can we possibly trust you in a position any higher than the one that we gave you and you screwed up?
Good question. Okay. And then you had one other one.
Well, I had a comment, too. I think that Joe Biden is very smart for not coming tonight. Now, for drama and to probably try and up their ratings with the general public, they have an extra podium there in case he shows up. But I'll tell you what he's doing. Hillary is notorious for staying out of the public eye, and her numbers go up. But the minute she comes out of hiding and opens her mouth, she buries herself. I think Uncle Joe is going to sit back and wait on this particular debate. Let her see if she buries herself. Then he can step in with clean hands, and he won't be accused of the backbiting that the Republicans are accused of with each other, especially against Donald Trump. I think he's playing it safe. I think that he's making a really shrewd move by creating the drama but not showing up.
Well, Bill, I'm going to let you go, but thank you for your call and your commentary. I would probably defer if I were Joe Biden. I'd probably show up, take the stage, shock everybody, and it would no longer be a snooze fest. It would turn into a slug fest. But we are going to bring you the Democrat live feed, the Dem convention, the Democrat debate in Las Vegas shortly. It's
nothing that we cannot accomplish. Tonight, the first Democratic debate of this presidential race. It's a critical test for a party superstar who's been down this road before.
Yeah, let's bring Clinton, it on.
The frontrunner, facing questions about her record, her emails, and the strength of her support. The former Secretary of State says her enemies are up to their old tricks.
I won't get down in the mud with them.
Bernie Sanders, the surprise threat, gaining in the polls despite critics who doubt he can go the distance.
Man, wouldn't it be awesome to have Joe Biden show up and steal the show
by rallying against the billionaire class?
Yes, we have the guts to take you on.
Three other political veterans are in the mix. Martin O'Malley, Jim Webb, and Lincoln Chafee have served in top elected offices, but they're struggling to get traction.
I know that it's a tough fight. I kind of like tough fights.
Now, the stage is set for the Democrats to drive home their differences with each other and with Republicans.
We're going to rattle their amnesia and force them to acknowledge reality.
The other Republican candidates, they are just Trump without the pizzazz or the hair.
In an election season that's breaking all the rules, this night in Vegas could change the odds once again.
Everyone, we are live at the Wynn Resort in Las Vegas for the CNN Facebook Democratic presidential debate. Welcome. The five major candidates are about to face off for the first time in a primary race that is a lot more competitive than many people had expected. Welcome, I'm Anderson Cooper. Thanks for joining us. We're just seconds away from introducing the candidates to viewers in the United States and watching right now around the world. This debate is airing on CNN, CNN en Español, and CNN International. It's also being broadcast on the Westwood One radio network. I'll be the moderator tonight. I'll also be joined in the questioning by my CNN colleagues, our chief political correspondent, Dana Bash, CNN en Español anchor Juan Carlos Lopez, and CNN anchor Don Lemon, who will share questions from Democrats nationwide. We've teamed up with Facebook to send a campaign camper around the country for the past 3 weeks. Thousands of people stepped inside to record their questions for the candidates on video. Millions more have weighed in on Facebook. Now it's time to meet the candidates. Joining us on stage, please welcome former Rhode Island Governor Lincoln Chafee. Governor Martin O'Malley.
Thanks.
Former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont. And former Senator Jim Webb of Virginia. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Democratic candidates for President of the United States. Now, everybody, please rise for our national anthem performed by 9-time Grammy Award-winning singer-songwriter Sheryl Crow.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. Still there, oh say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
I want to thank Sheryl Crow. The candidates are here. The crowd is certainly ready. The first Democratic debate will begin right after this.
Hey, we're going to take a quick break, and we will be right back after these messages. Whether you're an experienced shooter or just buying your first gun, Turner's Outdoorsman has everything you need, along with a knowledgeable and friendly staff to help you find that perfect gear for your next adventure. Turner's now has 18 locations across Southern California, including a Victorville location right on Bear Valley Road. Be sure to check out the new Archery Pro Shops in the Victorville, Chino Hills, and Pasadena locations. If you're not sure what you're looking for, you can browse and shop their selection at turners.com. Be sure to check out their weekly specials and sign up to get them delivered directly to your inbox. Turner's is where I turn for all my firearms and ammo needs. Remember to tell them Tim Donnelly sent you, and you'll get an additional discount. You're tuned to the Radio Free California Network, and we are streaming live, and we will continue even after our normal end time of 6 p.m. So stay tuned on our stream, and we're going to bring you the debate live without any further interruption.
Introduce themselves to our audience. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to introduce themselves. Let's begin with Governor Chafee. Governor?
Thank you, Anderson. Thank you, CNN. And thank you, Facebook, for organizing this debate. Not only will Americans be electing a new president next year, we also will be electing a world leader. Voters should assess the candidate's experience, character, and vision for the future as they make this important decision. I'm the only one running for president that has been a mayor, a United States senator, and a governor. As mayor, I brought labor peace to my city and kept taxes down. I was reelected 3 times. As a senator, I earned a reputation for courageous votes against the Bush-Cheney tax cuts that favored the wealthy, against the tragedy of the Iraq War, for environmental stewardship, for protection of our civil liberties. I served on the Foreign Relations Committee, and I chaired the Middle East Subcommittee for 4 years. As governor, I came in at the depths of the recession, and we turned my state around. Rhode Island had the biggest drop of the unemployment rate over my 4 budgets of all but one state. Happens to be Nevada, where we're having this debate. I'm very proud that over my almost 30 years of public service, I have had no scandals. I've always been honest, I have the courage to take the long-term view, and I've shown good judgment. I have high ethical standards. As we look to the future, I want to address the income inequality. Close the gap between the haves and the have-nots. I want to address climate change, a real threat to our planet. And I believe in prosperity through peace. I want to end these wars. I look forward to the discussion ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Governor. Senator Webb, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. Now, people are disgusted with the way that money has corrupted our political process, intimidating incumbents and empowering Wall Street every day with the turnstile government that we see, and also the power of the financial sector in both parties. They're looking for a leader who understands how the system works, who has not been co-opted by it, and also who has a proven record of accomplishing different things. I have a record of working across the political aisle. I've also spent more than half of my professional life away from politics in the independent world of being an author, a journalist, and a sole proprietor. In government service, I fought and bled for our country in Vietnam as a Marine. I spent years as an Assistant Secretary of Defense, Secretary of the Navy in the Reagan administration. In the Senate, I spoke about economic fairness and social justice from day one. I also wrote and passed the best piece of veterans education legislation in history, the post 9/11 GI Bill. I brought criminal justice reform out of the political shadows and into the national discussion. I led what later became called the strategic pivot to Asia, 2 years before President Obama was elected. I know where my loyalties are. My mother grew up in the poverty of East Arkansas, chopping cotton, picking strawberries. 3 of her 7 siblings died in childhood. My wife, Hung, came to this country as a refugee from war-torn Vietnam, learned English, a language that was not spoken at home, and earned her way into Cornell Law School. I have 5 daughters, Amy works with disabled veterans. Sarah is an emergency room nurse. Julia is a massage therapist. Emily and Georgia are still in school. My son Jim fought as an infantry marine on the bloody streets of Ramadi. You may be sure that in a Webb administration, the highest priority will be the working people who every day go out and make this country stronger at home and who give us the right reputation and security overseas under a common sense foreign policy. Thank you.
Governor O'Malley, you have 2 minutes.
My name is Martin O'Malley, former mayor of Baltimore, former governor of Maryland, a lifelong Democrat, and most importantly, a husband and a father. My wife, Katie, and I have 4 great kids, Grace and Tara and William and Jack. And like you, there is nothing we wouldn't do to give them healthier and better lives. There are some things that I have learned to do better in life than others. And after 15 years of executive experience, I have learned how to be an effective leader. Whether it was raising the minimum wage, making our public schools the best in America, passing marriage equality, the DREAM Act, and comprehensive gun safety legislation, I have learned how to get things done because I am very clear about my principles. Thanks to President Obama, our country has come a long way since the Wall Street crash of 2008. Our country's doing better. We are creating jobs again. But we elected a president, not a magician. And there is urgent work that needs to be done right now. For there is a deep injustice, an economic injustice that threatens to tear our country apart, and it will not solve itself. Injustice does not solve itself. What I'm talking about is this: our middle class is shrinking. Our poor families are becoming poorer, and 70% of us are earning the same or less than we were 12 years ago. We need new leadership, and we need action. The sort of action that will actually make wages go up again for all American families. Our economy isn't money, it's people. It's all of our people. And so we must invest in our country and the potential of our kids to make college a debt-free option for all families instead of saddling our kids with a lifetime of crushing debt. And we must square our shoulders to the great challenge of climate change and make this threat our opportunity. The future is what we make of it. We are all in this together. And the question in this election is whether you and I still have the ability to give our kids a better future. I believe we do. That is why I am running for president, and I need your help. Thank you.
Governor O'Malley, thank you very much. Senator Sanders.
Anderson, thank you very much. I think most Americans understand that our country today faces a series of unprecedented crises. The middle class of this country for the last 40 years has been disappearing. Millions of Americans are working longer hours for low wages, and yet almost all of the new income and wealth being created is going to the top 1%. As a result of this disastrous Citizens United Supreme Court decision, our campaign finance system is corrupt and is undermining American democracy. Millionaires and billionaires are pouring unbelievable sums of money into the political process in order to fund super PACs and to elect candidates who represent their interests, not the interests of working people. Today, the scientific community is virtually unanimous. Climate change is real. It is caused by human activity. And we have a moral responsibility to transform our energy system away from fossil fuel to energy efficiency and sustainable energy and leave this planet a habitable planet for our children and our grandchildren. Today in America, we have more people in jail than any other country on earth. African American youth unemployment is 51%. Hispanic youth unemployment
is 36%.
Hey, we are going to have to break away here, but we will be continuing to stream live at timdonnellyshow.com. You'll have to go there, click listen live, or download the TuneIn app, search Radio Free California Network on your phone, and we'll continue with live commentary. But for now, we're going to have to break away from you momentarily as your programming will be changing here shortly on at least on our affiliate stations. But I want to thank you for tuning in today. And by the way, if you want to continue with coverage, Radio Free California Network streams live at timdonnellyshow.com. So tune in. God bless you and Godspeed. Tim Donnelly Show out. You heard most of the candidates prior to us having to break away. This is the Tim Donnelly Show, Radio Free California Network, and we're going to go right back to the live stream. I know we probably missed Hillary, unfortunately.
About each of the candidates here on the stage that they have about each of you. Secretary Clinton, I want to start with you. Plenty of politicians evolve on issues, but even some Democrats believe you change your positions based on political expediency. You were against same-sex marriage, now you're for it. You defended President Obama's immigration policies, now you say they're too harsh. You supported his trade deal dozens of times, you even called it the gold standard. Now, suddenly last week, you're against it. Will you say anything to get elected?
Well, actually, I have been very consistent over the course of my entire life. I have always fought for the same values and principles, but like most human beings, including those of us who run for office, I do absorb new information, I do look at what's happening in the world. Take the trade deal. I did say when I was Secretary of State 3 years ago that I hoped it would be the gold standard. It was just finally negotiated last week. And in looking at it, it didn't meet my standards for more new good jobs for Americans, for raising wages for Americans. And I want to make sure that I can look into the eyes of any middle class American and say, this will help raise your wages. And I concluded I could not.
Secretary Clinton, though, with all due respect, the question is really about political expediency. Just in July, New Hampshire, you told the crowd you, quote, take a backseat to no one when it comes to progressive values. Last month in Ohio, you said you plead guilty to, quote, being kind of moderate and center. Do you change your political identity based on who you're talking to?
No. I think that, like most people that I know, I have a range of views, but they are rooted in my values and my experience. And I don't take a backseat to anyone when it comes to progressive experience and progressive commitment. You know, when I left law school, my first job was with the Children's Defense Fund. And for all the years since, I have been focused on how we're going to unstack the deck and how we're going to make it possible for more people to have the experience I had, you know, to be able to come from a grandfather who was a factory worker, a father who was a small business person, and now asking the people of America to elect me president.
Just for the record, are you a progressive or are you a moderate?
I'm a progressive, but I'm a progressive who likes to get things done. And I know how to find common ground, and I know how to stand my ground, and I have proved that in every position that I've had, even dealing with Republicans who never had a good word to say about
me,
honestly.
Here it goes. Here it goes.
But we found ways to work together on everything from reforming foster care and adoption to the Children's Health Insurance Program, which insures 8 million kids. So I have a long history of getting things done, rooted in the same values I've always had.
Senator Sanders, a Gallup poll says half the country would not put a socialist in the White House. You call yourself a democratic socialist. How can any kind of socialist win a general election in the United States?
Well, we're going to win because first we're going to explain what democratic socialism is. And what democratic socialism is about is saying that it is immoral and wrong that the top 0.1% in this country own almost 90%, own almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. That it is wrong today in a rigged economy that 57% of all new income is going to the top 1%. That when you look around the world, you see every other major country providing health care to all people as a right, except the United States. You see every other major country saying to moms that when you have a baby, we're not going to separate you from your newborn baby because we are going to have, medical and family paid leave like every other country on earth. Those are some of the principles that I believe in, and I think we should look to countries like Denmark, like Sweden, and Norway, and learn from what they have accomplished for their working people.
Denmark is a country that has a population of 5.6 million people. The question is really about electability here, and that's what I'm trying to get at. The Republican Attack Act against you in a general election, it writes itself. You supported the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, you honeymooned in the Soviet Union, and just this weekend you said you're not a capitalist. Doesn't that ad write itself?
Well, first of all, let's look at the facts. The facts that are very simple. Republicans win when there is a low voter turnout, and that is what happened last November. 63% of the American people didn't vote, Anderson. 80% of young people didn't vote. We are bringing out huge turnouts and creating excitement all over this country. Democrats at the White House on down will win when there is excitement and a large voter turnout, and that is what this campaign is doing.
You don't consider yourself a capitalist, though.
Do I consider myself part of the casino capitalist process by which so few have so much and so many have so little, by which Wall Street's greed and recklessness wreck this economy? No, I don't. I believe in a society where all people do well, not just a handful of billionaires.
Just to be clear, is there anybody else on the stage who's not a capitalist?
Well, let me just follow up on that, Anderson, because when I think about capitalism, I think about all the small businesses that were started because we have the opportunity and the freedom in our country for people to do that and to make a good living for themselves and their families. And I don't think we should confuse what we have to do every so often in America, which is save capitalism from itself. And I think what Senator Sanders is saying certainly makes sense in the terms of the inequality that we have. But we are not Denmark. I love Denmark. We're the United States of America, and it's our job to rein in the excesses of capitalism so that it doesn't run amok and doesn't cause the kind of inequities that we're seeing in our economic system. But we would be making a grave mistake to turn our backs on what built the greatest middle class in the history
Senator
of the
Sanders.
World.
I mean, everybody is in agreement that we are a great entrepreneurial nation. We have got to encourage that. Of course, we have to support small and medium-sized businesses. But you can have all of the growth that you want, and it doesn't mean anything if all of the new income and wealth is going to the top 1%. So what we need to do is support small and medium-sized businesses, the backbone of our economy, but we have to make sure that every family in this country gets a fair shake,
We're going to have a lot more on these issues, but I do want to just quickly get everybody in on the question of electability. Governor Chafee, you've been everything but a socialist. When you were senator from Rhode Island, you were a Republican. When you were elected governor, you were an independent. You've only been a Democrat for a little more than 2 years. Why should Democratic voters trust you won't change again?
Anderson, you're looking at a block of granite when it comes to the issues.
Whether it seems like pretty soft granite, though. I mean, you've been a Republican, you've been an independent.
Did you hear what I said on the issues? I have not changed on the issues. I was a liberal Republican, then I was an independent, and now I'm a proud Democrat, but I have not changed on the issues. And I opened my record to scrutiny, whether it's on the environment, a woman's right to choose, gay marriage, fiscal responsibility, aversion to foreign entanglements, using the tools of government to help the less fortunate. Time and time again, I have never changed. You're looking at a block of granite when it comes to the issue.
So why,
I have
why
not
change
changed.
Labels?
The party left me. There's no doubt about that. There was no room for a liberal, moderate Republican in that party. I even had a primary for my reelection in 2006. I won it, but the money poured in to defeat me in Rhode Island as a Republican. That's what we were up against.
Governor Malley, the concern of voters about you is that you tout your record as Baltimore's mayor. As we all know, we all saw that city exploded in riots and violence in April. The current top prosecutor in Baltimore, also a Democrat, blames your zero tolerance policies for sowing the seeds of unrest. Why should Americans trust you with the country when they see what's going on in the city that you ran for more than 7 years?
Yeah, actually, believe what she said was that there's a lot of policies that have led to this unrest. But Anderson, when I ran for mayor of Baltimore in 1999...
She actually, just for the record, when she was asked which policies to name two, she said zero tolerance. I mean, there's a number of old policies that we were seeing the result of that distrust of communities where communities don't want to step forward and say who killed a three-year-old. It's a direct result of these failed policies.
Let's talk about this a little bit. One of the things that was not reported during that heartbreaking night of unrest in Baltimore was that arrests had actually fallen to a 38-year low in the year prior to Freddie Gray's tragic death. Anderson, when I ran for mayor of Baltimore back in 1999, it was not because our city was doing well. It was because we had allowed ourselves to become the most violent, addicted, and abandoned city in America. And I ran and promised people that together we could turn that around. And we put our city on a path to reduce violent crime, or part one crime, by more than any major city in America over the next 10 years. I did not make our city immune to setbacks, but I attended a lot of funerals, including one for a family of seven who were firebombed in their sleep for picking up the phone in a poor African-American neighborhood and calling the police because of drug dealers on their corner. We've saved over 1,000 lives in Baltimore in the last 15 years of people working together, and the vast majority of them were young and poor and black. It wasn't easy on any day, but we saved lives and we gave our city a better future, improving police and community relations every single day that I was in office.
In 1 year alone, though, 100,000 arrests were made in your city, a city of 640,000 people. The ACLU, the NAACP sued you, sued the city, and the city actually settled, saying a lot of those arrests were without probable cause.
Well, I think the key word in your follow-up there was the word settled. That's true, that was settled. Arrests peaked in 2003, Anderson, but they declined every year after that as we restored peace in our poorer neighborhoods so that people could actually walk and not have to worry about their kids or their loved ones being victims of violent crime. Look, none of this is easy. None of us has all the answers. But together as a city, we saved a lot of lives. It was about leadership, it was about principle, and it was about bringing people together. Thank you.
Senator Webb, in 2006, you called affirmative action state-sponsored racism. In 2010, you wrote an op-ed saying it discriminates against whites. Given that nearly half the Democratic Party is non-white, aren't you out of step with where the Democratic Party is now?
No, actually, I believe that I am where the Democratic Party traditionally has been. The Democratic Party, and the reason I decided to run as a Democrat, has been the party that gives people who otherwise have no voice in the corridors of power a voice. And that is not determined by race. And as a clarification, I have always supported affirmative action for African Americans. That's the way the program was originally designed because of their unique history in this country with slavery and the Jim Crow laws that followed. What I have discussed a number of times is the idea that when we create diversity programs that include everyone, quote, of color, other than white, struggling whites like the families in the Appalachian Mountains, we're not being true to the Democratic Party principle of elevating the level of consciousness among our people about the hardships that a lot of people who happen to be white have, by culture, by the way.
Senator Webb, thank you very much. Let's move on to some of the most pressing issues facing our country right now, some of the most biggest issues right now in the headlines today. We're going to start with guns. The shooting in Oregon earlier this month, once again, it brought the issue of guns into the national conversation. Over the last week, guns have been the most discussed political topic on
Here
Facebook
we go
by
again.
2-1. Senator Sanders, you voted against the Brady Bill, mandated background checks and a waiting period. You also supported allowing riders to bring guns in checked bags on Amtrak trains. For a decade, you said that holding gun manufacturers legally responsible for mass shootings is a bad idea. Now you say you're reconsidering that. Which is it? Shield the gun companies from lawsuits or not?
Let's begin, Anderson, by understanding that Bernie Sanders has a D-minus voting record from the NRA. Let's also understand that back in 1988, when I first ran for the United States Congress, way back then, I told the gun owners of the state of Vermont, and I told the people of the state of Vermont, a state which has virtually no gun control, that I supported a ban on assault weapons. And over the years, I have strongly supported instant background checks, doing away with this terrible gun show loophole, and I think we've got to move aggressively at the federal level in dealing with the straw man purchases. Also, I believe, and I've fought for, to understand
that there are thousands of people in this country today who are suicidal, who are homicidal, but can't get the health care that they need, the mental health care, because they don't have insurance or they're too poor. I believe that everybody in this country has a mental crisis, has got to get mental health counseling immediately.
Do you want to shield gun companies from lawsuits?
Of course
not.
This was a large and complicated bill. There were provisions in it that I think made sense. For example, do I think that a gun shop in the state of Vermont that sells legally a gun to somebody, and that somebody goes out and does something crazy, that gun shop owner should be held responsible? I don't. On the other hand, where you have manufacturers and where you have gun shops knowingly giving guns to criminals or aiding and abetting that, of course we should take action.
Secretary Clinton, is Bernie Sanders tough enough on guns?
No, not at all. I think that we have to look at the fact that we lose 90 people a day from gun violence. This has gone on too long, and it's time the entire country stood up against the NRA. The majority of our country
stood up against the NRA. How about standing up against the criminals?
Even the majority of gun owners do. Senator Sanders did vote 5 times against the Brady bill. Since it was passed, more than 2 million prohibited purchases have been prevented. He also did vote, as he said, for this immunity provision. I voted against it. I was in the Senate at the same time. It wasn't that complicated to me. It was pretty straightforward to me that he was going to give immunity to the only industry in America. Everybody else has to be accountable, but not the gun manufacturers. And we need
and
to stand
Planned
up
Parenthood.
And say enough of that. We're not going to let it continue.
We're going to bring you all in on this, but Senator Sanders...
Yeah, the only industry in America that she wants to say that is designed to kill people, but Planned Parenthood, hello. You defend them.
The shouting in the world is not going to do what I would hope all of us want, and that is keep guns out of the hands of people who should not have those guns and end this horrible violence that
like
we
are criminals?
Seeing. I believe that there is a consensus in this country, a consensus that said we need to strengthen and expand instant background checks, do away with this gun show loophole, that we have to address the issue of mental health, that we have to deal with the straw man purchasing issue,
Senator,
and that when we develop that consensus,
Senator,
we can finally do something to address this crisis.
Governor O'Malley, you passed gun legislation as governor of Maryland, but you had a Democratic-controlled legislature. President Obama couldn't convince Congress to pass gun legislation after the massacres in Aurora, in Newtown, and Charleston. How can you?
And Anderson, I also had to overcome a lot of opposition in the leadership of my own party to get this done. Look, it's fine to talk about all of these things, and I'm glad we're talking about these things, but I've actually done them. We passed comprehensive gun safety legislation, not by looking at the pollings or looking at what the polls said. We actually did it. And Anderson, here tonight in our audience are two people that make this issue very, very real. Sandy and Lonnie Phillips are here from Colorado. And their daughter, Jessie, was one of those who lost their lives in that awful mass shooting in Aurora. Now, to try to transform their grief, they went to court, where sometimes progress does happen when you file in court. But in this case, you want to talk about a rigged game, Senator? The game was rigged. A man had sold 4,000 rounds of military ammunition to this person that killed their daughter, riddled her body with 5 bullets, and he didn't even ask where it was going. And not only did their case get thrown out of court, they were slapped with $200,000 in court fees because of the way that the NRA gets its way in our Congress, and we take a back seat. It's time to stand up and pass comprehensive gun safety legislation as a nation.
Senator Sanders, I want you to be able to respond. Yeah, 30 seconds.
I think the governor gave a very good example about the weaknesses in that law, and I think we have to take another look at it. But here is the point, Governor. We can raise our voices, but I come from a rural state, and the views on gun control in rural states are different than in urban states, whether we like it or not. Our job is to bring people together around strong, common sense gun legislation. I think there is a vast majority in this country who want to do the right thing, and I intend to lead the country in bringing our people together on that issue.
Senator, excuse me. Senator, it was not about rural. Senator, it was not about rural and urban.
It is exactly about rural.
Have you ever been to the Eastern Shore? Have you ever been to Western Maryland? We were able to pass this and still respect the hunting traditions of people who live in our rural areas. And we did it,
Governor,
Anderson, by leading with principle, not by pandering to the NRA.
Oh, you got to be kidding me. So this is Martin O'Malley defending his record in Maryland when Baltimore, one of the biggest cities in Maryland, became a killing field. You can't make this stuff up. So the gun store is supposed to ask what you're going to do with the ammo that you buy? You're going to hold them responsible?
Senator Webb, you're rating from the NRA. You once had an A rating from the NRA. You said gun violence goes down when more people are allowed to carry guns. Would encouraging
exactly.
more people to be armed be part of your response to a mass shooting?
Look, there are two fundamental issues that are involved in this discussion, and we need to pay respect to both of them. The first is the issue of who should be kept from having guns and using firearms. And we have done not a good job on that. A lot of them are criminals, and a lot of the people are getting killed are members of gangs inside our urban areas, and a lot of them are mentally incapacitated. In the shooting in Virginia Tech in 07, this individual had received medical care for mental illness from three different professionals who were not allowed to share the information. So we do need background checks. We need to keep the people who should not have guns away from them. But we have to respect the tradition in this country of people who want to defend themselves and their family from violence.
Senator,
there are people are going back and forth here for 10 minutes here. You know, there are people at high levels in this government who have bodyguards 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The average American does not have that and deserves the right to be able to protect their family.
Senator Governor Chafee, you have an F rating from the NRA. What do you think about what Senator Webb just said?
Yes, I have a good record of voting for common sense gun safety legislation. But the reality is, despite these tragedies that happen time and time again, when legislators step up to pass common sense gun safety legislation, the gun lobby moves in and tells the people they're coming to take away your guns. And they're successful at it. In Colorado and other states, the legislators that vote for common sense gun safety measures then get defeated. I even saw it in Rhode Island. So I would bring the gun lobby in and say, we've got to change this. Where can we find common ground? Wayne LaPierre from the NRA, whoever it is, the leaders, come on, we've got to change this. We're
Thank
not
you.
Coming to take away your guns. We believe in the Second Amendment, but let's find common ground here.
Anderson, when the NRA wrote to everyone in our state, when the NRA wrote to the members in our state and told people with hunting traditions lies about what our comprehensive gun safety legislation is, I wrote right back to them and laid out what it actually did. And that's why not only did we pass it, but the NRA didn't
Thank
dare
you.
To petition it to referendum because we built a public consensus.
I want to move on to another issue, which is in the headlines right now, another crisis-making headline. Secretary Clinton, Russia, they're challenging the U.S. in Syria. According to U.S. intelligence, they've lied about who they're bombing. You spearheaded the reset with Russia. Did you underestimate the Russians as president? What would your response to Vladimir Putin be right now in Syria?
Well, first of all, we got a lot of business done with the Russians when Medvedev was the president and not Putin. We got a nuclear arms deal. We got the Iranian sanctions. We got an ability to bring important material and equipment to our soldiers in Afghanistan. There's no doubt that when Putin came back in and said he was going to be president, that did change the relationship. We have to stand up to his bullying, and specifically in Syria, it is important, and I applaud the administration because they are engaged in talks right now with the Russians to make it clear that they've got to be part of the solution to try to end that bloody conflict and to provide safe zones so that people are not going to have to be flooding out of Syria at the rate they are. And I think it's important, too, that the United States make it very clear to Putin that it's not acceptable for him to be in Syria, creating more chaos, bombing people on behalf of Assad. And we can't do that if we don't take more of a leadership position, which is what I'm advocating.
Senator Sanders, what would you do differently?
Well, let's understand that when we talk about Syria, you're talking about a quagmire in a quagmire. You're talking about groups of people trying to overthrow Assad, other groups of people fighting ISIS. You're talking about people who are fighting ISIS using their guns to overthrow Assad and vice versa. I'm the former chairman, Anderson, of the Senate Veterans Committee. And in that capacity, I learned a very powerful lesson about the cost of war. And I will do everything that I can to make sure that the United States does not get involved in another quagmire like we did in Iraq, the worst foreign policy blunder in the history of this country. We should be putting together a coalition of Arab countries who should be leading the effort. We should be supportive. But I do not support American ground troops in Syria.
On this issue of foreign policy, I want to go to Dana Bash.
Governor Chafee, you were the only Republican in the Senate to vote against the Iraq war. You say Secretary Clinton should be disqualified from the presidency because she voted in favor of using force in Iraq. She has since said that her vote was a mistake. Why isn't that good enough?
Well, we just heard Senator Sanders say that it's the worst decision in American history. That's very significant. The worst decision in American history, I just heard from Senator Sanders. So as we look ahead, if you're going to make those poor judgment calls at a critical time in our history, we just finished with the Vietnam era, getting back into another quagmire. If you're looking ahead and you're looking at someone that made that poor decision in 2002 to go into Iraq when there was no real evidence of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, I know because I did my homework. And so that's an indication of how someone will perform in the future, and that's what's important.
Secretary Clinton, he's questioning your judgment.
Well, I recall very well being on a debate stage, I think about 25 times, with then-Senator Obama debating this very issue. After the election, he asked me to become Secretary of State. He valued my judgment, and I spent a lot of time with him. Well, in the Situation Room,
Bernie Sanders takes Hillary to school on foreign policy in Russia, and then Hillary strikes back and takes him to school on politics
on the ground in Syria. I never said that. What I said was we had to put together a coalition, in fact, something that I worked on before I left the State Department to do. And yes, it should include Arabs, people in the region, because what I worry about is what will happen with ISIS gaining more territory, having more reach, and frankly, posing a threat to our friends and neighbors in the region and far beyond. So I think whether you're talking about the tough decision that President Obama had to make about Osama bin Laden, where I was one of his few advisors, or putting together that coalition to impose sanctions on Iran, I think I have a lot of evidence
Senator Sanders, I want to bring you in here. My question for you is, as a congressman, you voted against the Iraq War. You
voted
against
the Gulf War. Yeah, that was flat out funny when Hillary said that Obama values my judgment. Really?
President Sanders actually used
Obama's the reason you're in so much trouble, Hillary.
Let me just respond to something the secretary said. First of all, she is talking about, as I understand it, a no-fly zone in Syria, which I think is a very dangerous situation, could lead to real problems. Second of all, I heard the same evidence from President Bush and Dick Cheney and Don Rumsfeld about why we should overthrow Saddam Hussein and get involved in the war. I would urge people to go to BernieSanders.com, hear what I said in 2002, and I say without any joy in my heart that much of what I thought would happen about the destabilization, in fact, did happen. So I think the president is trying very hard to thread a tough needle here. And that is to support those people who are against Assad, against ISIS, without getting us on the ground there. And that's the direction I believe we should have.
But Senator Sanders, you didn't answer the question. Under what circumstances would you actually use force?
Well, obviously, I voted when President Clinton said, let's stop ethnic cleansing in Kosovo. I voted for that. I voted to make sure that Osama bin Laden was held accountable in Afghanistan. When our country is threatened, or when our allies are threatened, I believe that we need coalitions to come together to address the major crises of this country. I do not support the United States getting involved in unilateral action. Let's work with our allies.
I'm going to bring you all in on this. Governor O'Malley, Secretary Clinton voted to authorize military force in Iraq, supported more troops in Afghanistan. As Secretary of State, she wanted to arm Syrian rebels and push for the bombing of Libya. Is she too quick to use military force?
Anderson, no president, no commander-in-chief should take the military option off the table, even if most of us would agree that it should be the last option. What disturbed people so much about, and I would agree with Senator Sanders on this, leading us into Iraq under false pretenses and telling us as a people that there were weapons of mass destruction there was one of the worst blunders in modern American history. But the reason why people remain angry about it is because people feel like a lot of our legislators got railroaded in a war fever and by polls. And I remember being at a dinner shortly before that invasion. People were talking at the and saying, well, it'll take us just a couple years to rebuild democracy. And I thought, has this world gone mad? Whenever we go in contrary to John Quincy Adams' advice, searching the world for monsters to destroy, and when we use political might to take it at the expense of democratic principle, we hurt ourselves and we hurt our kids.
Does she want to use military force too rapidly?
I believe that as president, I would not be so quick to pull for a military tool. I believe that a no-fly zone in Syria at this time, actually, Secretary, would be a mistake. You have to enforce no-fly zones. And I believe, especially with the Russian Air Force in the air, it could lead to an escalation because of an accident that we would deeply regret. I support President Obama. I think we have to play a long game. And I think ultimately, you want to talk about blunders? I think Assad's invasion of Syria will be seen as a blunder.
Governor O'Malley, just for the record, on the campaign trail, you've been saying that Secretary Clinton is always quick for the military invention. Senator, Secretary Clinton, you can respond.
Well, first
Anderson,
of all,
can I get into this discussion at some point?
Well, yes, you'll be coming in next, but she was directly quoted.
Thank you. So. I've been standing over here for about 10 minutes trying.
Okay.
Hey, buddy, if you want to stand around, you're not going to make it to president. You've got to get on center stage. You've got to command some presence. I feel like they need to take two or three of these guys out. They're just so boring.
President in 2008, and I enjoyed his strong support in that campaign, and I consider him obviously a friend. Let me say, because there's a lot of loose talk going on here, we are already flying in Syria, just as we are flying in Iraq. The president has made a very tough decision. What I believe and why I have advocated that the no-fly zone, which of course would be in a coalition, be put on the table is because I'm trying to figure out what leverage we have to get Russia to the table. You know, diplomacy is not about getting to the perfect solution. It's about how you balance the risk.
Thank you.
And I think we have an opportunity here. And I know that inside the administration, this is being hotly debated. To get that leverage, to try to get the Russians to have to deal with everybody in the region Anderson. To begin to move toward a political, diplomatic solution
Thank you, Secretary.
In Syria.
Anderson, Senator Webb, you said as president you would never have used military force in Libya and that the attack on the U.S. consul in Benghazi was, in your words, inevitable. Should Secretary Clinton have seen that attack coming?
Look, let's start by trying to get in this conversation for about 10 minutes. Let's start with why Russia is in Syria right now.
He's still
there
whining.
There are three strategic failings that have allowed this to occur. The first was the invasion of Iraq, which destabilized ethnic elements in Iraq and empowered Iran. The second was the Arab Spring, which created huge vacuums in Libya and in Syria that allowed terrorist movements to move in there. And the third was the recent deal allowing Iran to move forward and eventually acquire a nuclear weapon, which sent bad signals, bad body language into the region about whether we are acquiescing in Iran becoming a stronger piece of the formula in that part of the world. Now, I say this as someone who spent 5 years in the Pentagon and who opposed the war in Iraq, whose son fought in Iraq. I fought in Vietnam. But if you want a place where we need to be in terms of our national strategy, a focus, the greatest strategic threat that we have right now is resolving our relationship with China. And we need to do this because of their aggression in the region. We need to do it because of the way they treat their own people. And I would say this. I've been waiting for 10 minutes. I will say this.
You're over your time, though.
You've let a lot of people go over their time. I would say this.
You agreed to these debate rules.
To the unelected, authoritarian government of China, you do not own the South China Sea. You do not have the right to conduct cyber warfare against tens of millions of American citizens. And in a Webb administration, we will do something about that.
Senator Sanders, I want you to be able to respond.
Pardon me?
I'd like you to be able to respond and get in on this.
Well, I think Mr. Putin is going to regret what he is doing. I think that when he gets into that...
He doesn't seem to be the type of guy to regret a lot.
Well, I think he is already regretting what he did in Crimea and what he is doing in the Ukraine. I think he is really regretting the decline of his economy. And I think what he is trying to do now is save some face. But I think when Russians get killed in Syria and when he gets bogged down, I think the Russian people are going to give him a message that maybe they should come home. Maybe they should start working with the United States to rectify the situation there.
Secretary Clinton, on the campaign trail, Governor Webb has said that he would never have used military force in Libya and that the attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi was inevitable. Should you have seen that attack coming?
Well, let's remember what was going on. We had a murderous dictator, Gaddafi, who had American blood on his hands, as I'm sure you remember, threatening to massacre large numbers of the Libyan people. We had our closest allies in Europe burning up the phone lines, begging us to help them try to prevent what they saw as a mass genocide, in their words. And we had the Arabs standing by our side saying, we want you to help us deal with Gaddafi. Our response, which I think was smart power at its best, is that the United States will not lead this. We will provide essential, unique capabilities that we have. But the Europeans and the Arabs had to be first over the line. We did not put one single American soldier on the ground in Libya. And I'll say this for the Libyan
people. But American citizens did lose their lives in Benghazi.
But I'll get to that. But I think it's important,
oh, wow,
since I understand Senator Webb's very strong feelings about this, to explain where we were then and to point out that I think President Obama made the right decision at the time. And the Libyan people had a free election the first time since 1951. And you know what? They voted for moderates. They voted with the hope of democracy. Because of the Arab Spring, because of a lot of other things, there was turmoil to be followed. But unless you believe the United States should not send diplomats to any place that is dangerous, which I do not, then when we send them forth, there is always the potential for danger and risk.
Governor O'Malley?
Anderson, I think there's lessons to be learned from Benghazi. And those lessons are that we need to do a much better job as a nation of having human intelligence on the ground so that we know who the emerging next generation leaders are that are coming up to replace a dictator when his time on this planet ends. And I believe that's what Chris Stevens was trying to do, but he did not have the tools. We have failed as a country to invest in the human intelligence that would allow us to make not only better decisions
for
in Libya,
a minute there, I thought he was talking about replacing Obama
today,
as the dictator.
It's a huge national security failing.
Senator Webb, I want you to be able to
thank
respond.
You.
Anderson,
I'd
like
this was
shot
not,
too, please.
Senator Webb.
This is not about Benghazi per se. For me, it is the inevitability of something like Benghazi occurring in the way that we intervened in Libya. We had no treaties at risk. We had no Americans at risk. There was no threat of attack or imminent attack. There is plenty of time for a president to come to the Congress and request authority to use military force in that situation. I called for it on the Senate floor again and again. I called for it in Senate hearings. It is not a wise thing to do. And if people think it was a wise thing to do, try to get to the Tripoli airport today. You can't do it.
Secretary Webb, you served in Vietnam. You're a Marine. Once a Marine, always a Marine. You served as a Marine in Vietnam. You're a decorated war hero. You eventually became Secretary of the Navy. During the Vietnam War, the man standing next to you, Senator Sanders, applied for status as a conscientious objector. Given his history, can he serve as a credible commander-in-chief?
Now, everybody makes their decisions, particularly when the time there is conscription. And as long as they go through the legal process that our country requires, I respect that. And it would be for the voters to decide, you know, whether Senator Sanders or anyone else should be president. I will say this, coming from the position that I've come from a military family, with my brother a Marine, my son was a Marine in Iraq, I served as a Marine, spending 5 years in the Pentagon, I am very comfortable that I am the most qualified person standing up here today to be your commander-in-chief.
Senator Sanders, tell an American soldier...
I always love it when somebody says
right
I'm the most qualified person possible.
Why you could be commander-in-chief,
how arrogant.
Given that you applied
well, first
for conscientious objector status.
Let me applaud my good friend Jim Webb for his service to this country in so many ways. Jim and I under Jim's leadership, as he indicated, passed the most significant veterans education bill in recent history. We followed suit with a few years later, passing under my leadership the most significant veterans health care legislation in the modern history of this country. When I was a young man, I'm not a young man today.
Hey, if you are just tuning in, this is the Radio Free California Network. We are streaming live the Democrat debate out of Las Vegas. And you have missed some fireworks. One of the latest things, you had Hillary Clinton actually say that when Anderson Cooper asked her, hey, by the way, American lives were lost in Benghazi, she said, I'll get to that, dismissing it as if it was of no importance.
That war should be the last resort, that we have got to exercise our diplomacy. But yes, I am prepared,
Senator,
to take this country into
war. Bernie Sanders, self-avowed socialist, proud anti-war.
Security threat to the United States. I want to go down the line.
Okay, I just have to answer one thing that Senator Webb said about the Iran deal, because I'm a strong proponent of what President Obama, and he said that because of the Iran deal, that enabled Russia to come in. No, that's not true, Senator Webb. I respect your foreign policy chops, but Russia is aligned with Iran and with Assad and the Alawite Shias in Syria. So that the Iran deal did not allow Russia
Senator,
to come
in. Okay, Senator, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to respond.
I believe that the signal that we sent to the region when the Iran nuclear deal was concluded was that we are accepting Iran's greater position in this very important balance of power among our greatest ally, Israel, and the Sunnis represented by the Saudi regime and Iran. It was a position of weakness, and I think it encouraged the acts that we've seen in the past several weeks.
30 seconds for each of you. Governor Chafee, what is the greatest national security threat to the United States?
It's certainly the chaos in the Middle East. There's no doubt about it.
Okay.
And it all started with the Iraq invasion.
Governor O'Malley?
I believe that nuclear Iran remains the biggest threat, along with the spread of ISIL. Climate change, of course, makes cascading threats even worse.
Secretary Clinton, the greatest national security threat.
I think it has to be continuing threat from the spread of nuclear weapons, nuclear material that can fall into the wrong hands. I know the terrorists are constantly seeking it, and that's why we have to stay vigilant, but also united around the world to prevent that.
Senator Sanders, greatest national security
threat. Meanwhile, she supports Barack Obama's Iran deal.
Transform our energy system away from fossil fuel to sustainable energy. The planet that we're going to be leaving our kids and our grandchildren may well not be habitable. That is a major crisis.
Senator Webb.
Our greatest long-term strategic challenge is our relations with China. Our greatest day-to-day threat is cyber warfare against this country. Our greatest military operational threat is resolving these situations in the Middle East.
All right, we're going to take a short break. Do these candidates see eye to eye on an issue that is driving a big wedge between Republicans? That is next. We'll be right back.
Hey, if you're just tuning in to the Radio Free California Network, we're going to bring you up to speed here. You have missed very little. It was a snooze fest as predicted, but we were able to glean some key points. You know, the first speaker was Lincoln Chafee. I had to cross off the name five times because I wasn't sure who was speaking. He's actually a good speaker, former Republican. He stressed his record. He stressed that he has integrity. He made a great point about the fact that he does not currently have, nor has he ever had, any public scandals. And, of course, that was a slap in the face to Hillary Clinton. Then you had Jim Webb, who has a very deep voice, and he's really aggressive, kind of passive aggressive. He is not making a lot of friends. He's just throwing around buzzwords. And one thing that he did when he had been waiting for too long because he didn't know how to insert himself into the debate, at least smoothly or segue himself into the debate, he began complaining how he hadn't been heard from in 10 minutes. And then when he went overtime, he kind of embarrassed himself, because whenever you cut off the host and tell him you deserve more time, then the onus is on you to say something fascinating. You've got to, I don't know, make a point something. By the way, if you want to weigh in, we'll take your calls on these breaks. 323-746-TALK. If you've got something to say, Bernie Sanders came out of the box swinging and made it clear that he hates rich people. If you have made it, if you're a capitalist, you're a casino capitalist. You just got lucky, and it's the government's job to deprive you of your wealth and give it to other people. He talks about how he is only standing up for working people. And I noticed that there was this real consensus among all the candidates. There's no difference among any of them. The science is in. It's unanimous. Bernie Sanders was perhaps the most vocal, saying we have a moral responsibility to transform our economy and transform our planet and make it habitable. That means he wants to have the government change the temperature by changing the type of energy we use, because he believes that man can ultimately impact that, and that the government is the correct way to affect that change that he believes there is a tremendous amount of consensus on. One thing I like about Bernie Sanders, the guy is a unabashed socialist. He could care less what anybody thinks. He does not equivocate or apologize for his complete opposition to the war. He doesn't believe in war at all. And he really has been undoing Hillary. Sean, have you been enjoying the way that Hillary has sort of had to backtrack and pander and say all kinds of bizarre things, particularly when he challenged her on a number of things, but including Benghazi?
Well, yeah, but she always comes back with this, you know, like, I'm the foreign policy expert around here, not you.
So. Yeah, but she made a point that Sanders supported her for Secretary of State. But of course, almost all Democrats would. Well, yeah. He's not even a Democrat. Let me rephrase that. But he sounded more intelligent on Russia, and she has to defend her policy, so she sounds defensive. And he's coming out, and he sounds like such an outsider, even though he's been a senator from Vermont for God knows how many years. It's Vermont, right? Not New Hampshire.
Right. We're coming back now, so.
Okay, well, we will be bringing you more of the Snooze Fest in Las Vegas.
Far more challenging crises as president.
Well, I've taken responsibility for it. I did say it was a mistake. What I did was allowed by the State Department, but it wasn't the best choice. And I have been as transparent as I know to be, turning over 55,000 pages of my emails, asking that they.
Oh, my God. I've been as transparent as I know how to be.
I've been asking.
Give me a break. Somebody go after her.
Which was not originally agreed to. But let's just take a minute here and point out that this committee is basically an arm of the Republican National Committee. It is a
right-wing conspiracy
vehicle, as admitted by the House Republican Majority Leader, Mr. McCarthy, to drive down my poll numbers. Big surprise. And that's what they have attempted to do. I am still standing. I am happy to be part of this debate. And I intend to keep talking about the issues that matter to the American people. You know, I believe strongly that we need to be talking about what people talk to me about. Like, how are we going to make college affordable? How are we going to pay down student debt? How are we going to get health care for everybody?
And Secretary Clinton,
there you go. Blame Republicans. Lie and blame Republicans.
Isn't it a little bit hard for you to call this just a partisan issue? There's an FBI investigation, and President Obama himself just 2 days ago said this is a legitimate issue.
Well, I never said it wasn't legitimate. I said that I have answered all the questions, and I will certainly be doing so again before this committee. But I think it would be really unfair not to look at the entire picture. This committee has spent $4.5 million of taxpayer money, and they said that they were trying to figure out what we could do better to protect our diplomats so that something like Benghazi wouldn't happen again. There were already 7 committee reports.
Well, she's
about
never
what
even
to do.
Answered for
so
Benghazi.
I think it's pretty clear what their obvious goal is, but I'll be there. I'll answer their questions. But tonight, I want to talk not about my emails, but about what the American people want from the next president
Senator
of the United
Sanders.
States.
What happened to what difference does it make? What difference does it make?
Let me say something that may not be great politics,
But I think the secretary is right. And that is that the American people are sick and tired of hearing about your damn emails.
Thank you. Me too.
Oh, my word. Really smooth there, Sanders.
And let me say something about the media as well. I go around the country, talk to a whole lot of people. Middle class of this country is collapsing. We have 27 million people living in poverty. We have massive wealth and income inequality. Our trade policies have cost us millions of decent jobs. The American people want to know whether we're going to have a democracy or an oligarchy as a result of Citizens United. Enough of the emails. Let's talk about the real issues facing America.
So Bernie Sanders, the socialist, just sank his campaign and took away the one weapon he had against Hillary and said it doesn't matter and gave her a pass. You're just as corrupt as all the other politicians.
I know that plays well in this room, but I got to be honest, Governor Chafee, for the record, on the campaign trail, you've said a different thing. You said this is a huge issue standing here in front of Secretary Clinton. Are you willing to say that to her face?
Absolutely. We have to repair American credibility after we told the world that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction, which he didn't. So there's an issue of American credibility out there. So anytime someone's running to be our leader and a world leader, which the American president is, credibility is an issue out there with the world, and we have repair work to be done. I think we need someone that has the best in ethical standards as our next president. That's how I feel.
Secretary Clinton, do you want to respond?
No.
Governor. Yeah.
Governor, that's O'Malley. A shot.
Yeah.
Again, it's popular in the room, but a lot of people do want to know these answers. Governor
boy.
O'Malley, you expressed concern
are having a little love fest, a Hillary love fest. You're going to excuse Benghazi. You're going to excuse the emails. You basically, there's no point in having any other candidates then. Just coronate Hillary.
Defined by the email scandal and how long, what the FBI is asking about. Instead, we can talk about affordable college, making college debt free, and all the issues, which is why, and I see the chair of the DNC here, look how glad we are actually to be talking about the issues that matter most to people around their kitchen table. We need to get wages to go up, college more affordable.
Thank you, Governor.
We need to make America 100% clean electric by 2050.
I want to talk about issues of race in America. For that, I want to start off with Don Lemon. Don?
All right, Anderson, thank you very much. Not sure how to follow that, but this question is about something that has tripped some of the candidates up out on the campaign trail. Can you hear me? Can't hear me in the room. Okay, here we go again.
University
As
Law
I said,
School, my question for the candidates is, do Black lives matter or do all lives matter?
Whoa.
The question from Arthur in Des Moines
well,
is,
there we go.
Do Black lives matter or do all lives matter? Let's put that question to Senator Sanders.
Black lives matter. And the reason those words matter is the African-American community knows that on any given day, some innocent person like Sandra Bland can get into a car, and then 3 days later, she's going to end up dead in jail. Or their kids are going to get shot. We need to combat institutional racism from top to bottom, and we need major, major reforms in a broken criminal justice system in which we have more people in jail than China. And I intend to tackle that issue to make sure that our people have education and jobs rather than jail cells.
Governor O'Malley, the question from Arthur was, do Black lives matter, do all lives matter?
Yeah, and Anderson, the point that the Black Lives Matter movement is making is a very, very legitimate and serious point.
No, it's a big fat fraud, and you all know it.
Of Black lives, people of color.
Black Lives Matter was started by a white guy. Hands in the air is a fraud. It never happened.
Every single year, mostly young and poor and black. And I said to our legislature at the time when I appeared in front of them as a mayor, that
yeah, Martin, and more people died on your watch. More people died in the city you were mayor of,
we would be marching in the streets
than have died in some war zone since the beginning of this year, thanks to you and your policies.
We have a lot of work to do to reform our criminal justice system and to address race relations in our country.
Secretary Clinton. What would you do for African Americans in this country that President Obama couldn't?
Well, I think that President Obama has been a great moral leader on these issues and has laid out an agenda that has been obstructed by the Republicans at every turn. So what we need to be doing is
a great moral leader. You hate Obama and Obama hates you, but you call him a great moral leader. I love it. I love it.
Cameras. But we also need to be following the recommendations of the commission that President Obama impaneled on policing. There is an agenda there that we need to be following up on. Similarly, we need to tackle mass incarceration. And this may be the only bipartisan issue in the Congress this year. We actually have people on both sides of the aisle who have reached the same conclusion that we cannot keep imprisoning more people than anybody else in the world. But I believe that the debate and discussion has to go further, Anderson, because we've got to do more about the lives of these children. That's why I started off by saying we need to be committed to making it possible for every child to live up to his or her God-given potential. That is really hard to do if you don't have early childhood education, if you don't have schools that are able to meet the needs of the people or good housing. There's a long list. We need a new deal.
Yeah. I'll give you all kinds of free stuff. I'm going to protect you from the 1% by taking money from the 1%. Yay, I'm Hillary Clinton.
As President of the United States, every life in this country matters. At the same time, I believe I can say to you, I have had a long history of working with the situation of African Americans. We're talking about criminal justice reform. I risked my political life raising the issue of criminal justice reform. When I ran for the Senate in Virginia in 06, I had Democratic Party political consultants telling me I was committing political suicide. We led that issue in the Congress. We started a national debate on it, and it wasn't until then that the Republican Party started joining in. I also represented a so-called war criminal, African-American Marine, who was wounded, who was convicted of murder in Vietnam for 6 years. He took his life 3 years into this. I cleared his name after 3 years.
Thanks,
and
Senator.
I put the African-American soldier on the mall. I made that recommendation and fought for it. So if you want someone who is
this guy is so boring. I don't know what he's saying. I don't remember who he is.
I have taken the risks.
But he is sure happy with himself.
Let's talk about income inequality. Wages and incomes are flat. You've argued that the gap between rich and poor is wider than at any time since the 1920s. We've had a Democratic president for 7 years. What are you going to be able to do that President Obama didn't?
Well, first of all, let's remember where we were when Bush left office. We were losing 800,000 jobs.
Here we go. Blame Bush. Blame Bush. Blame Bush.
My Republican friends seem to have some amnesia on this issue, but the world's financial crisis was on the verge, world's financial markets system was on the verge of collapse. That's where we were. Are we better off today than we were then? Absolutely. But the truth is that for the last 40 years, the great middle class of this country has been disappearing. And in my view, what we need to do is create millions of jobs by rebuilding our crumbling infrastructure, raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour, have pay equity for women workers, end our disastrous trade policies, which have cost us millions of jobs, and make every public college and university in this country tuition free.
Secretary Clinton, I'll let you jump in a moment.
Anderson.
Everybody will get in on this in a moment. Secretary Clinton, how would you address this issue? In all candor, you and your husband are part of the 1%. How can you credibly represent the views of the middle class?
Well, you know, both Bill and I have been very blessed. Neither of us came from wealthy families, and we've worked really hard our entire lives.
Yeah,
and I want
really
to
hard.
Make sure every single person in this country has
yeah,
the same
you have all these donors and all this money coming in, and
their God-given
and you made all these investments that miraculously panned out into millions of dollars.
They should have in America for
and never
good
got held accountable for any
good
insider
job
trading.
Training and then good
blessed.
Jobs. I have a 5-point economic plan because this inequality challenge we face, we have faced it at other points. It's absolutely right. It hasn't been this bad since the 1920s.
But if you look at the Republicans versus the Democrats
under a Democrat.
When it comes to economic policy, there is no comparison.
Thank you.
The economy does better when you have a Democrat in the White House, and that's why we need to have a Democrat in the White House in January 2017.
Governor O'Malley, I want you to be able to...
Yep. Anderson, I want to associate myself with many of the items that the senator from Vermont mentioned, and I actually did them in our state. We raised the minimum wage, passed the living wage, invested more in infrastructure, went 4 years in a row without a penny's increase for college tuition. But there's another piece that Senator Sanders left out tonight, but he's been excellent about underscoring that. And that is that we need to separate the casino, speculative, mega bank gambling that we have to ensure with our money from the commercial banking, namely reinstating Glass-Steagall. Secretary Clinton mentioned my support 8 years ago. And Secretary, I was proud to support you 8 years ago, but something happened in between. And that is, Anderson, a Wall Street crash that wiped out millions of jobs and millions in of savings for families. And we are still just as vulnerable, Paul Volcker says today. We need to reinstate Glass-Steagall, and that's a huge difference on this stage among us as candidates.
I do, just for viewers at home who may not be reading up on this, Glass-Steagall's Depression-era banking laws repealed in 1999 and prevented commercial banks from engaging investment banking and insurance activities. Secretary Clinton, I mean, he raises a fundamental difference on this stage. Senator Sanders wants to break up the big Wall Street banks. You don't. You say charge the banks more, continue to monitor them. Why is your plan better?
Well, my plan is more comprehensive, and frankly, it's tougher because, of course, we have to deal with the problem that the banks are still too big to fail. We can never let the American taxpayer and middle-class families ever have to bail out the kind of speculative behavior that we saw. But we also have to worry about some of the other players.
This is the Radio Free California Network, broadcasting on great radio stations like Talk 960 Victorville and on the web at timdonnellyshow.com.
Insurance company, Lehman Brothers, an investment bank. There's this whole area called shadow banking. That's where the experts tell me the next potential problem could come from. So I'm with both Senator Sanders and Governor O'Malley in putting a lot of attention onto the banks. And the plan that I have put forward would actually empower regulators to break up big banks if we thought they posed a risk. But I want to make sure we're going to cover everybody.
As long as they have contributed to you, they will not be regulated.
Senator Sanders, Secretary Clinton just said that her policy is tougher than yours.
Well, that's not true.
why?
Let us be clear that the greed and recklessness and illegal behavior of Wall Street, where fraud is a business model, helped to destroy this economy and the lives of millions of people. Check the record. In the 1990s, and all due respect, in the 1990s, when I had the Republican leadership and Wall Street spending billions of dollars in lobbying, when the Clinton administration, when Alan Greenspan said, what a great idea it would be to allow these huge banks to merge, Bernie Sanders fought them and helped lead the opposition to deregulation. Today, it is my view that when you have the three largest banks in America, are much bigger than they were when we bailed them out for being too big to fail, we have got to break them up.
Secretary Clinton, you have to be able to respond. Yeah. He brought you up.
You know, I respect the passion and intensity. I represented Wall Street as a senator from New York, and I went to Wall Street in December of 2007, before the big crash that we had, and I basically said, cut it out. Quit foreclosing on homes. Quit engaging in these kinds of speculative behaviors. I took on the Bush administration for the same thing. So I have thought deeply and long about what we're going to do exactly what I think both the senator and the governor want, which is to rein in and stop this risk. And my plan would have the potential of actually sending the executives to jail. Nobody went to jail after $100 billion in fines.
Hillary wants to send somebody else to jail, but she doesn't want to answer for her own emails.
You
can't make this stuff up.
Only you look at the big banks, you may be missing the forest for the trees.
Senator Sanders, you have to be able to respond.
All the other financial institutions. He has to be able to respond.
Bernie, say my name.
You don't not. I will get you a second.
Okay, thank you.
I'll tell him. In my view, Secretary Clinton,
You do not, Congress does not regulate Wall Street. Wall Street regulates Congress. And we have got to break off these banks, going to them and saying, please do the right thing.
No, that's
is
not what
kind of that, naive.
Look, I think Dodd-Frank was a very good start. And I think that we have to implement it. We have to prevent the Republicans from ripping it apart. We have to save the Consumer Financial Protection Board, which is finally beginning to act to protect consumers. We have work to do. You get no argument from me. But I know if we don't come in with a very tough and comprehensive approach like the plan I'm recommending, we're going to be behind instead of ahead
Governor
of what
Malley,
the next crisis could
stand?
Be.
Anderson, look, this is the big banks. I mean, once we repealed Glass-Steagall back in the late 1999s, the big banks, the six of them, went from controlling with the equivalent of 15% of our GDP to now 65% of our GDP. And right before this debate, Secretary Clinton's campaign put out a lot of reversals on positions on Keystone and many other things. But one of them that we still have a great difference on, Madam Secretary, is that you are not for Glass-Steagall. You are not for putting a firewall between this speculative, risky shadow banking behavior. I am. And the people of our country need a president who's on their side, willing to protect the Main Street economy from recklessness on Wall Street. We have to
Secretary
fulfill
Clinton,
our promise.
I have to let you respond.
Well, you know, everybody on this stage has changed a position or two. We've been around a cumulative quite some period of time. You know, we know that if you are learning, you're going to change your position. I never took a position on Keystone until I took a position on Keystone. But I have been on the forefront of dealing with climate change starting in 2009 when President Obama and I crashed a meeting with the Chinese and got them to sign up to the first international agreement to combat climate change that they'd ever joined. So
Thank
I'm
you.
Not taking a backseat to anybody on my Thank values, my principles, and the results that I get.
Senator Sanders. Senator Sanders, in 2008, congressional leaders were told without the 2008 bailout, the U.S. was possibly days away from a complete meltdown. Despite that, you still voted against it. As president, would you stand by your principles if it risked the country's financial stability?
Well, I remember that meeting very well. I remember it like it was yesterday. Hank Paulson, Bernanke came in and they said, guys, the economy is going to collapse because Wall Street is going under. It's going to take the economy with them. And you know what I said to Hank Paulson? I said, Hank, your guys, you come from Goldman Sachs, your millionaire and billionaire friends caused this problem. How about your millionaire and billionaire fans paying for the bailout, not working families in this country? So to answer your question, no, I would not have let the economy collapse. But it was wrong to ask the middle class to bail out Wall Street. And by the way, I want Wall Street now to help kids in this country go to college, public colleges and universities, free from a Wall Street
Sanders knows how to turn the screw
and
make Hillary look like a casino capitalist.
Take on Wall Street. Is the system rigged?
There is a reality that I think we all need to recognize with respect to the power of the financial sector.
Right.
And let me just go back a minute and say that on this TARP program, I introduced a piece of legislation calling for a windfall profits tax on the executives of any of these companies that got more than $5 billion, that it was time for them, once they got their compensation and their bonus, to split the rest of the money they made with the nurses and the truck drivers and the soldiers who bailed them out. With respect to the financial sector, I mean, I know that my time's run out, but I mean, in speaking of changing positions, and
I know my time has run out, but I want to bore you further.
Because
please listen to
name,
me.
I can't get into the discussion.
You agree to these rules, and you're wasting time. So
well,
if you would finish your
right,
answer,
well,
we'll
I'm trying to set a mark here, so maybe we can get into a little more later on. This hasn't been equal time. But if
whining,
you
whining. Why would you spend your time whining?
In terms of how we're going to deal with this. Since that crash, in the last 10 years, the amount of the world's capital economy that Wall Street manages has gone from 44% to 55%. That means the Wall Street money managers are not risking themselves as the same way the American people are when they're going to get their compensation. They're managing money from all over the world.
Thank you.
We have to take that into consideration when we're looking at ways to regulate it.
Governor Chafee, you've attacked Secretary Clinton for being too close to Wall Street banks. In 1999, you voted for the very bill that made banks bigger.
The Glass-Steagall was my very first vote. I just arrived. My dad had died in office. I was appointed to the office. It was my very first vote.
Are you saying you didn't know what you were voting for?
I just arrived the Senate. I think we'd get some takeovers. That was one. It was my very first vote, and it was 92-5. It was the reconciliation.
With all due respect, what does that say about you, that you're casting a vote for something you weren't really sure about?
I think you're being a little rough. I just arrived at the United States Senate. I've been mayor of my
word.
City. My dad had
this
died.
This is
I've
pathetic.
Been by the governor. It was the first vote, and it was
92-5. You know what? I like Sanders way better than this
but
politician.
Let me just say about income inequality. We've had a lot of talk over the last few minutes, hours, or tens of minutes, but no one's saying how we're going to fix it. And it all started with the Bush tax cuts that favored the wealthy.
Blame Bush.
0.6% of Americans are at the top echelon, over 464,000. 0.6 of Americans. That's less than 1%. But they generate 30% of the revenue.
Thank you,
and
Governor.
They're doing fine. So there's still a lot more money to be had from this top echelon. I'm saying let's have another.
Yeah, I think you definitely need to do a shot every time they mention
the
Bush.
Bracket, and that'll generate $42 billion.
Bring
and then
Janet
we can
Ash.
Help. The middle-class and hard-earning hardworking Americans.
Thank you. CNN visited college campuses along with Facebook, and not surprisingly, college affordability was among the most pressing issues. Senator Sanders, you've mentioned a couple of times you do have a plan to make public colleges free for everyone. Secretary Clinton has criticized that in saying she's not in favor of making a college free for Donald Trump's kids. Do you think taxpayers should pick up the tab for wealthy children?
Well, let me tell you, Donald Trump and his billionaire friends under my policies are going to pay a hell of a lot more in taxes today.
Taxes yeah, punish the rich, punish
today.
The rich. Come on, go after him, Bernie.
Education, this is what I think. This is the year 2015.
You also need to take a shot anytime you hear the word billionaire.
Is the equivalent of what a high school degree was 50 years ago. And what we said 50 years ago and 100 years ago is that every kid in this country should be able to get a high school education regardless of the income of their family. I think we have to say that is true for everybody going to college. I think we don't need a complicated system, which the secretary is talking about. Your income goes up, your income is down. If you're poor, you have to work, and so forth and so on. I pay for my program, by the way, through a tax on Wall Street speculation, which will not only make public colleges and universities tuition-free, it will substantially lower interest rates on college debt, a major crisis in this country.
And Secretary Clinton, it's not just college tuition. Senator Sanders is talking about expanding Social Security and giving all Americans Medicare. What's wrong with that?
Well, let me address college affordability, because I have a plan that I think will really zero in on what the problems are. First, all the 40 million Americans who currently have student debt will be able to refinance their debt to a low interest rate. That will save thousands of dollars for people who are now struggling under this cumbersome, burdensome college debt. As a young student in Nevada said to me, the hardest thing about going to college should not be paying for it. So then we have to make it more affordable. How do we make it more affordable? My plan would enable anyone to go to a public college or university tuition free. You would not have to borrow money for tuition. But I do believe, and maybe it's because I worked when I went through college, I worked when I went through law school, I think it's important for everybody to have some part of getting this accomplished. That's why I call it a compact.
Secretary
so yes,
Clinton.
I would like students to work 10 hours a week.
Can you answer
in
the-
order to make it possible for them to afford their education? And I want colleges to get their costs down. They are outrageously high
Secretary
in
Clinton,
what they're charging.
The question was not just about tuition, though. It was about Senator Sanders' plan to expand Social Security, to make Medicare available to all Americans. Is that something that you would support? And if not, why not?
Well, I fully support Social Security. And the most important fight we're going to have is defending it against continuing Republican efforts
you want
to privatize
to expand it.
I want
blame
to
Republicans.
Enhance
blame Republicans.
The benefits for the poorest recipients of Social Security. We have a lot of women on Social Security, particularly widowed and single women who didn't make a lot of money during their careers. And they are impoverished, and they need more help from the Social Security system.
Jenny.
And I will focus on helping those people who need it the most. And of course, I'm going to defend Social Security. I'm going to look for ways to try to make sure it's solvent into the future.
And we
she is so boring. She talks so long. I don't even know what she's saying, except blame Republicans, blame Republicans.
And some Democrats. We're talking about cutting Social Security and benefits for disabled veterans through the so-called chain CPI. I founded a caucus called the Defending Social Security Caucus. My view is that when you have millions of seniors in this country trying to get by, and I don't know how they do, on $11,000, $12,000, $13,000 a year, you don't cut Social Security, you expand it. And the way you expand it is by lifting the cap on taxable incomes so that you do away with the absurdity of a millionaire paying the same amount into the system as somebody making $118,000.
Senator,
you do that, Social Security is solvent until 2061, and you can expand that.
Senator Sanders, I want to bring it over to Juan Carlos Lopez from CNN en Español. We're obviously in Nevada. It's had the highest percentage of undocumented immigrants of any state in the country as of last year. Juan Carlos?
Gracias, Anderson. Senator Sanders, in 2013, you voted for immigration reform. But in 2007, when Democrats controlled Congress and the Bush White House was on board, you voted against it. Why should Latino voters trust you now when you left them at the altar at the moment when reform was very close?
I didn't leave anybody at the altar. I voted against that piece of legislation because it had guest worker provisions in it, which the Southern Poverty Law Center talked about being semi-slavery. Guest workers are coming in, they're working under terrible conditions, but if they stand up for their rights, they're thrown out of the country. I was not the only progressive to vote against that legislation for that reason. Tom Hawken, a very good friend of Hillary Clinton's and mine, one of the leading labor advocates, also voted against that.
Tom Hawken isn't running for president.
I know
you
that.
Are.
But a point being is that progressives did vote against that for that reason. My view right now, and always has been, is that when you have 11 million undocumented people in this country, we need comprehensive immigration reform. We need a path toward citizenship. We need to take people out of the shadows.
And Juan Carlos.
Yes, Secretary Clinton, Governor O'Malley wants to open up Obamacare to millions of undocumented immigrants and their children, including almost 90,000 people right here in Nevada. Do you?
Well, first of all, I want to make sure every child gets health care. That's why I helped to create the Children's Health Insurance Program. And I want to support states that are expanding health care and including undocumented children and others. I want to open up the opportunity for immigrants to be able to buy in to the exchanges under the Affordable Care Act. I think to go beyond that, as I understand what Governor O'Malley has recommended, so that they would get the same subsidies, I think that is it raises so many issues. It would be very difficult to administer. It needs to be part of comprehensive immigration reform when we finally do get to it.
Governor O'Malley.
Yeah, Juan Carlos, I think what you've heard up here is some of the old thinking on immigration reform, and it's why it's gridlocked. We need to understand that our country's made stronger in every generation by the arrival of new American immigrants. That is why I have put out a policy for comprehensive immigration reform. That is why I would go further than President Obama has on
the amnesty love fest. Here it comes.
I mean, we are a nation of immigrants. We are made stronger by immigrants. Do you think for a second that simply because somebody's standing in a broken queue on naturalization, they're not going to go to the hospital and that care isn't going to fall onto our insurance rates? I am for a generous, compassionate America that says we're all in this together. We need comprehensive immigration reform. It'll make wages go up in America, $250 for every
average
family.
Senator Webb, do you support the undocumented immigrants getting Obamacare?
I wouldn't have a problem with that. Let me start by saying my wife is an immigrant. She was a refugee. Her family escaped from Vietnam on a boat, her entire extended family, after the communists took over, when hundreds of thousands of people were out there and thousands of them were dying. She went to two refugee camps. She never spoke English in her home, and she ended up, as I said, graduating from Cornell Law School. That's not only the American dream, that's the value that we have with a good immigration system in place. No country is a country without defining its borders. We need to resolve this issue. I actually introduced an amendment in the 07 immigration bill, giving a pathway to citizenship to those people who had come here and put down their roots and met a series of standards.
Senator.
We lost, but I introduced that in 07. Secretary, so we need a comprehensive reform, and we need to be able to define our borders.
Secretary Clinton.
I want to follow up, because I think underneath Juan Carlos's important questions, there is such a difference between everything you're hearing here on this stage and what we hear from the Republicans,
here, here.
Who have demonized hardworking immigrants, who have insulted them. You know, I came to Las Vegas in, I think, early May, met with a group of dreamers. I wish everybody in America could meet with these young people to hear their stories, to know their incredible talent, their determination. And that's why I would go further than even the executive orders that President Obama has signed when I'm president.
Secretary Clinton, let me ask you, two of your rivals from your left, Governor O'Malley and Senator Sanders, want to provide in-state college tuition to undocumented immigrants. Where do you stand on that?
My plan would support any state that takes that position and would work with those states and encourage more states to do the same
thing.
So,
on the record, you believe that undocumented immigrants should get in-state college tuition?
If their states agree, then we want more states to do the same.
Governor O'Malley?
And Anderson, we actually did this in my state of Maryland. We passed a state version of the Dream Act. And a lot of the xenophobes, the immigrant haters, like some that we've heard, like Donald Trump, that carnival barker in the
there
Republican Party.
There they go. First
Party,
time they mentioned Donald Trump.
Tried to mischaracterize it as free tuition for illegal immigrants. But we took our case to the people when it was petitioned to referendum, and we won with 58% of the vote. The more our children learn, the more they will earn, and that's true of children who have yet to be naturalized, but will become American
Senator
citizens.
Sanders, you talked about your record on the Veterans Affairs Committee. You served on that committee for the last 8 years, including 2 years as its chairman, while veterans died waiting for health care. You and Senator McCain ultimately addressed the issue with bipartisan legislation. Why did it take 18 Inspector General reports and a CNN investigation and others before you and your colleagues took action?
Well, I was chairman for 2 years. And when I was chairman, we did take action. What we did is pass a $15 billion piece of legislation, which brought in many, many new doctors and nurses into the VA so that veterans in this country could get the health care when they needed it and not be on long waiting lines. And the other part of that legislation said that if a veteran is living more than 40 miles away from a VA facility, that veteran could get health care from a community health center or the private sector. As a result of that legislation, we went further than any time in recent history in improving health care to the men and women of this country who put their lives on the line to defend us.
Governor Chafee, you and Hillary Clinton both voted for the Patriot Act, which created the NSA surveillance program. You've emphasized civil liberties, privacy during your campaign. Aren't these two things in conflict?
No, that was another 99-1 vote for the Patriot Act, and it was seen as, at the time, modernizing our ability to do what we've always done to tap phones, which always required a warrant. And
do you
voted
regret
for
that.
Now, no. As long as you're getting a warrant, I believe that under the Fourth Amendment, you should be able to do surveillance. But you need a warrant. That's what the Fourth Amendment says. And in the Patriot Act, Section 215 started to get broadened too far. So I would be in favor of addressing and reforming Section 215 of the Patriot
Secretary
Act.
Secretary Clinton, do you regret your vote on the Patriot Act?
No, I don't. I think that it was necessary to make sure that we were able, after 9/11, to put in place the security that we needed. And it is true that it did require that there be a process. What happened, however, is that the Bush administration began to
there she chip goes
away
again.
At that process. And I began
Bush,
to speak
Bush,
out
Bush,
about
blame
their
Bush.
Use of warrantless surveillance and the other behavior that they engage in. We always have to keep the balance of civil liberties, privacy, and security. It's not easy in a democracy, but we have to keep it in mind.
And Senator Sanders, you're the only one on this stage who voted against the Patriot Act.
Was it 99-1 or maybe the one? I don't know.
And the reauthorization
votes. But
here's
the point.
Let me ask you, if elected, would you shut down the NSA surveillance program?
I'm sorry?
Would you shut down the NSA surveillance program?
Absolutely, of course.
You would, point blank.
Well, I would shut down. I'd shut down what exists right now is that virtually every telephone call in this country ends up in a file at the NSA. That is unacceptable to me. But it's not just government surveillance. I think the government is involved in our emails, is involved in our websites. Corporate America is doing it as well. If we are a free country, we have the right to be free. Yes, we have to defend ourselves against terrorism, but there are ways to do that without impinging on our constitutional rights and our privacy
rights. Anderson, the NSA
Governor Chafee, Edward Snowden, is he a traitor or a hero?
No, I would bring him home. The courts have ruled that what he did was
Bring him home, no jail time?
The American government was acting illegally. That's what the federal courts have said. What Snowden did showed that the American government was acting illegally per the Fourth
Secretary
Amendment.
Clinton,
so I would bring
hero
him home.
Or traitor?
Yes.
He broke the laws of the United States. He could have been a whistleblower. He could have gotten all of the protections of being a whistleblower. He could have raised all the issues that he has raised. And I think there would have been a positive response to that.
Should he do
jail time? In addition, he stole very important information that has unfortunately fallen into a lot of the wrong hands.
Governor O'Malley?
I don't think he should be brought home without facing the music.
Governor O'Malley, Snowden.
Anderson, Snowden put a lot of Americans' lives at risk. Snowden broke the law. Whistleblowers do not run to Russia and try to get protection from Putin. If he really believes that, he should be back here.
Senator Sanders, Edward Snowden.
I think Snowden played a very important role in educating the American people to the degree in which our civil liberties and our constitutional rights are being undermined.
Is he a hero?
He did break the law, and I think there should be a penalty to that. But I think what he did in educating us should be taken into consideration before he is
Senator Webb, Edward Snowden.
I would leave his ultimate judgment to the legal system. Here's what I do believe. We have a serious problem in terms of the collection of personal information in this country. And one of the things that I did during the FISA bill in 2007, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, was introduced with Russ Feingold two amendments basically saying, we understand the realities of how you have to collect this broad information in the internet age, but after a certain period of time, you need to destroy the personal information that you have if people have not been if criminal justice proceedings have not been brought against them. We've got a vast data bank of information that is ripe for people with bad intentions to be able to use, and they need to be destroyed.
Another question for each of you, starting with Governor Chafee. Name the one thing, the one way that your administration would not be a third term of President Obama.
Certainly ending the wars. We've got to stop these wars. We have to have a new dynamic, a new paradigm. We're just spent $500 million arming and training soldiers, the rebel soldiers in Syria. They quickly joined the other side.
President Obama's generals right now are suggesting keeping troops in Afghanistan after the time he wanted them pulled out. Would you keep them there?
I'd like to finish my question, my answer. And also, we just bombed a hospital. We've had drone strikes that hit civilian weddings. So I would change our approach to the Middle East. We need a new paradigm in the Middle East.
Governor O'Malley, how would you be different than President Obama's administration?
I would follow through on the promise that the American people thought we made as Democratic Party to protect the Main Street economy from recklessness on Wall Street. I would push to separate out these too big to jail, too big to fail banks and put in place
too big to jail, too big to fail.
That creates a firewall so that this wreckage of our economy can never happen again.
Secretary Clinton, how would you not be a third term of President Obama?
Well, I think that's pretty obvious. I think being the first woman president would be quite a change from the
Oh, here she pulls the woman card.
We've had up until this point, including President Obama.
Is there a policy difference?
Well, there's a lot that I would like to do to build on the successes of President Obama. But also, as I'm laying out, to go beyond. And that's in my economic plans, how I would deal with the prescription drug companies, how I would deal with college, how I would deal with a full range of issues that I've been talking about throughout this campaign to go further.
Senator Sanders?
I have a lot of respect for President Obama. I have worked with him time and time again on many, many issues. But here's where I do disagree. I believe that the power of corporate America, the power of Wall Street, the power of the drug companies, the power of the corporate media is so great that the only way we really transform America and do the things that the middle class and working class desperately need is through a political revolution when millions of people begin to come together and stand up and say our government is going to work for all of us, not just a handful of billionaires.
Senator Webb, how would you not be a third term for Obama?
I got a great deal of admiration and affection for Senator Sanders, but Bernie, I don't think the revolution's going to come, and I don't think the Congress is going to pay for a lot of this stuff. And if there would be a major difference between my administration and the Obama administration, it would be in the use of executive authority. I came up as a committee counsel in the Congress, used to put dozens of bills through the House floor every year as a committee counsel in the Veterans Committee. I have a very strong feeling about how our federal system works and how we need to lead and energize the congressional process instead of allowing these divisions to continue to paralyze what we're doing. So I would lead working with both parties in the Congress and working through them in the traditional way that our Constitution
Senator Sanders, he cited you. You don't hear a lot of Democratic presidential candidates talking about revolution. What do you mean?
What I mean is that we need to have one of the larger voter turnouts in the world, not one of the lowest. We need to raise public consciousness. We need the American people to know what's going on in Washington in a way that today they do not know. And when people come together in a way that does not exist now, and are prepared to take on the big money interest, then we can bring the kind of change we need.
Anderson, talked about a revolution. What we need is a green energy revolution. We need to move America to a 100% clean electric grid by 2050
and
create 5 million jobs along the way.
And we're going to talk more about climate change and environmental issues coming up. Some of the candidates have tried marijuana, as have pretty much probably everybody in this room. Others have not. Does that influence... Does it influence their views on legalization? Find out that and others ahead.
Hey, we here at the Radio Free California Network, we're going to leave you here. We've covered most of this. It is going to get down to the boring details of whatever it is they want to talk about next. But I think the fireworks are done. The important stuff is done. We will say good night, Godspeed, and we'll talk to you again tomorrow. Thanks for all your help, Sean. And thanks to all of you who are listening. Godspeed. By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed, at the twilight's last gleam. This is the Radio Free California Network, broadcasting on great radio stations like Talk 960 Victorville and on the web at timdonnellyshow.com.